You know, that's awesome when somebody like you of your legend status is like, I'm so happy. Oh, yeah, because you could easily not be happy.
Oh yeah,
right.
I really could. It's just it's just nice to have it in line, man, and ready to rock. So.
Yeah, good for you, man.
So yeah. Anyways, here we go. Welcome to another episode of To the Fullest with Jason Froberg. Make sure you hit that subscribe button underneath. Give us a like. Hit the bell. Today, my guest, legendary guitar player, Mr. Keith Roberts.
Hey.
What you up to today, brother?
Oh, my goodness. Keith Roberts. Do you know I dropped the S many years ago?
Oh, it's Keith Robert.
Yeah, I just
Keith
never tell anybody.
No, it is. It is Keith Robert. I write it down as Keith Robert, too.
I know.
And then it just came out that way.
You know, it's my middle name. My real last name is Warchalak.
Oh, right.
Right. And I think I missed an opportunity my whole life to just use that name. It was just too cool. But I think I mentioned this last time. I just had too much pride in trying to be a rock star.
Yeah.
I had to shorten it down a little bit. You know? But I'm using Warchalak a little bit more too lately.
Yeah.
You know, I'm just getting back to my roots.
Well, Keith Warchalak.
Thank you.
Killing it
I'm
today.
Coming out. Warchalak.
Coming out as Warchalak. Yeah. Robert's actually my, that's my mom's side of the family.
Oh,
man.
Is it really?
Yeah, so I actually related to a lot of Roberts out there.
Interesting.
Yeah. Oh. I'm going to see him actually in a week or so, man. I haven't seen
that's
him in a long
north,
time.
That's up north, right?
Yeah, up north, man. So it'll be nice. We're going to stop and hit some camping on the way, try to get into Yosemite and do a first come, first serve campsite and shit like that. Hopefully we get in. Who knows, man? Go in the middle of the week and try for it.
Oh, you'll score.
Yeah.
Your timing will be good.
Yeah, it's going to be great. Yeah,
that camping trip must be awesome.
I'm looking forward to it. I don't think I've ever been to Yosemite, man.
Wow.
So,
are you going to go see that geyser?
I hope so. If it's nearby or something, you know, we'll get some shots of it for the YouTube.
Yeah, I would be the one that shows up like 300 miles away from it. You know, I'll be on like the North Rim instead of wherever it is, wherever that big geyser is. What's that thing called?
Shit, I don't even know, man.
Troopers,
I can
creepers.
Listen
to me.
It's a old, isn't it old?
I was not paying attention.
Or something like that.
I was not paying. Yeah, exactly. I was not paying it. You know, I wasn't paying attention in class. I was just signing my name and thinking about KISS.
That's right, man. You know, that's the important stuff.
But I knew it was some geyser. I'm not that stupid. I just forgot.
There's actually a bunch of geysers out there, I believe. And it is Old Faithful.
Imagine Old Faithful. Right. What a silly concept. I mean, the thing like goes off every hour.
Yeah.
Like, isn't that weird?
Oh, it's amazing, man. You know? And
cheers.
Cheers indeed. I'm drinking my thermos of unknown liquid.
I'm drinking my thermos. Advertising too. Well, so, I'd like to say your new studio is fabulous.
Oh, thank you so much, man.
It is not that the old one was, you know, bad. I'm just saying, you know, it's like
this is better.
Wow. It's like unbelievable. So, if anybody knew the dedication that you had, you know, all your followers. I know you have a lot of great friends on that, but all the newcomers are coming around. This guy's a legend right here. This is the real legend right here, right now.
Thank you so much, man.
I envy your. Your capability to be able to put this stuff together correctly.
It takes a lot of trial and error, for sure.
Of course.
I always say fail forward, man.
I usually just get through trial.
Yeah. Oh. No, it was, dude, getting to this point was, man, just failure after failure and buying new gear and just, you know, figuring it out as I went, man. And it's finally stabilized to a place where it's just click and go.
Totally.
And I know what all the buttons do.
Yep.
That's like the hardest part is the
autopilot,
where you
right?
know where all the buttons are and what they do. And you're just ready to push them and they work.
Great. I love all this gear. It's so well done.
Yeah. Thank you so much, man.
It's my Howard Stern experience.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We try to do it professional, man.
Great.
And you know, we got the beautiful Accessibles microphone stands.
Tell you about that. Accessibles.com. There you go.
Oh, yeah.
It's a shameless plug.
It's a beautiful place to get amazing gear at a super affordable price.
Yes, thank you.
You know, we did some commercials with you guys.
We
did. That was fantastic.
You did a phenomenal job. You produced, shot, wrote, recorded, all the above, edited, released. You did everything. It was really phenomenal. What a great job you do with audio and video work, man.
Thank you so much.
You brought a lot of joy to us at Accessibles.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun doing it, man.
Yeah.
And I was able to show it off to some other friends who have some Amazon pages and they're looking to jump on them.
Expand the business.
Yeah, have me do some of it. I'm actually looking to do my own Amazon page pretty soon here. I'm looking for wholesalers and somewhere, you know, trying to get into some kind of place where I can get a good price on some gear and Just start pushing it, man.
You know, if you got a good idea, you know, if you can come up with your own idea, because like I work with Amazon a lot, and I'm learning a little bit. I see a lot of stuff, and I'm really interested in it and what I do from 9 to 5. It's an interesting business, especially with Amazon. What a giant!
Yeah,
what an incredible giant. I mean, they've got everything laid out. I mean, it's frustrating at times. You know, but for the most part, it's a unique and adventurous outlet for retail. But if you can come up with your own idea and make that margin on your own idea, that's really important. I mean, really powerful, really good for the pocket, you know. So there's many avenues. I wish you luck with that.
Thank you so much. Yeah.
It's a lot of fun.
Oh, yeah.
If you need any help with FBA, I'm your man.
Oh, thank you so much, man.
I love FBA. It's crazy. Just send a bunch of stuff to Amazon and they just sell it for you, you know?
Yeah, and so for people who don't know, that's where you palletize all your gear and then you send it off to Amazon warehouse. And then
FBA,
they can,
fulfilled by Amazon.
Boom.
Right? So you just palletize everything. Throw a bunch of stickers on it. They call those FN SKU stickers. Anybody who out there is, you know, bought anything on Amazon, go ahead, check your package right now. There's a little sticker on there, a black and white sticker with a barcode. That's your FN SKU, baby.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's your personal ID number.
So you just get a space set up in your garage, slap a bunch of SKUs on there, and start sending them off to FBA, and Amazon will sell it for you. Yeah.
You know the Pish guy?
No.
You ever seen this guy? Oh,
I haven't
hilarious.
Seen the Pish guy.
His nickname is Chip Diamond. He goes by Chip Diamond in the videos, and he just has these random conversations with people, and he just goes psst. Like, he's just like, you know, like typical New York Philadelphia guy. He goes into like gyms, and he's like, you know, walking by like the buff guys, and he's like psst. You can't lift more. I can lift more than that. And he just starts ribbing people. It's hilarious. So that's really, really, really funny. Do it on YouTube. We all watch it and everything like that.
Oh, yeah. He's a YouTube celebrity.
Yeah, yeah. He, you know, goes to like the car lot and he's like pushing the car. He's kicking the tires. And the salesman's like, come on, man. What are you doing here? He's like, psh. He goes, what kind of car are you looking for? He's like, psh. You know, he's like, I got all the money in the world. Psh. So psh is a good thing in our lives right now. So if you're out there and you're frustrated, just go, psh.
Chip Diamond, huh?
Chip Diamond.
I see
Ed
this
Bassmaster.
Goober.
Yeah, the channel is called Ed Bassmaster. Not to be plugging anybody else on your show.
That's okay, man. I give him a little bit of love here.
Spread the YouTube people.
Right? Look at, I can show off his little page at least, man. Ed Bassmaster. There it
Bassmaster,
is.
Bassmaster, yeah. Bassmaster.
Bassmaster.
He's
Bassmaster.
Just a ball buster, you know, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania ball buster. He's not the New York type ball buster. He's not the New Jersey type ball buster, but I think he's a PA guy.
Well, I'm going to subscribe to him right now.
Oh,
there you
funny.
Go.
There you go.
Much love.
Hey, I just want you to know, I got like four like YouTube accounts and I'm all subscribing and I'm all like liking. And you know what? I play your videos even when I'm not watching. I just
Thank
let them run.
You.
I'm just trying to help out. Just trying to kick in. Everybody who's out there, like, subscribe. Help this gentleman out. This is a great thing that you're doing for the community. It's a great thing that you're doing for this town and the friends that are all in here helping out with their art and their music and everything like that. I know you're bringing a lot of joy to a lot of people, you know, Thank just you. Being able to come out on their platform and being able to have a lot of fun. And join the 21st century, which is great podcasting.
Yeah.
So you're doing a great job.
I like it, man, and it's great to have my friends in here and just have good conversations with them, help them promote what they're up to, and, you know, as it grows, you know, hopefully I'll be able to get my friends out to a bigger and better audience, man, as it gets going, and yeah, but that's definitely the game, man, the more hours I can get out of people.
Hey, when I watching. Really believe in you, I'm subscribing, I'm liking, I'm pushing, I'm sharing, whatever it takes, you know, so it's the least people can do, you know, it's, you know, help out a friend,
it's
hit that
free.
Like button, subscribe, just hit the button.
Yeah.
That's all you got to do.
Yeah.
You might get some cool stuff in your life.
Yeah. And and I'm bringing in a lot of different talent now, man. I got a ton of, I'm out mixing again.
Yes.
And so, like, that's my new hustle. Every band I mix, I go, hey, what's up? You know, most of them I already know, but even the ones I don't know, man, you know, I just talk to them, I'm nice to them. And then I go, hey, have you seen my podcast? You should subscribe to my podcast. You want to come on my podcast?
Of course.
So I think tomorrow I have, Stanley Avenue coming on the podcast.
Okay, I'm not familiar.
And they're just a local band doing the cover thing. I met them over at Area 15 where I've been doing some sound.
Yeah.
And they're
Area
a great
15?
Band. Yeah, it's right off the freeway.
That Crazy Place?
Yeah, The Crazy Place, man.
With all that shit in it?
Yeah.
Get out of here.
Yeah, it's fun.
Oh, my God.
Dude, my brother, like, did all the install work.
Get out.
And, yeah, him and another good friend of ours.
If anybody doesn't know what Area 15, it's wild. It's got the Van Gogh thing in, right?
Yeah, the Van Gogh thing's pretty tight right now.
And by the way, so, like, okay, I hate to say this on air and everything like that, but have you seen it? Did you go through it?
I didn't go through it.
Okay.
I've seen it from the booth where they're pushing the buttons. Well, yeah, and it's just 3D mapping.
It was okay. It was okay. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Then we did the virtual tour. I highly recommend the virtual tour if anybody's going.
Is that the Virtualis?
Yes. It was like the virtual reality kind of thing where you put.
Yeah.
Oh, that was beautiful.
What's up with that anyways? Like, because I'm doing audio and stuff, so we're installing speakers and I'm running the bands and whatnot. But, yeah. But I'm not really all the booths are separate from the actual events, like a shopping mall,
it's
right?
Wild.
So I don't get to go in those and do anything.
I didn't realize what it was like. Yeah. You know, you got the bar, you got the different types of shops, the axe throw in, the I can't even remember the golfing. You've got the Van Gogh museums. You've got this crazy shop mart where people go in. It was wild, and it goes into like a whole party. Like if you're doing a lot of drugs, kids.
It's the place.
This is the place to go.
It's designed for that shit.
If I was 20 years old, younger, and I was doing some drugs, this would be the place to go.
Oh, that's definitely the truth, man.
It's wild.
It's a psychedelic little paradise, man. The whole thing's a big art installation. Yeah. Everything is trippy and psychedelic.
It's wild.
And it's the place for that, for sure.
Hey, and I have to tell you, I realized something very, very interesting.
Yeah.
And Shanti agreed with me. My lovely wife. Hello, Shanti.
Hi, Shanti.
Yes. You reminded us of Van Gogh.
I do?
Yes. You look like Van Gogh.
I guess I got the look right now, don't
yes.
I? I got the beard and the slicked back hair, and it's kind of red.
Very, very artistic, very creative, very... Just a force to be reckoned with in any creativity of the world. You've got.
You're too kind.
Yeah, I was thinking of you again. Always thinking of you. When I went to go see Van Gogh, I go, my God, it's Jason.
Let me get a picture of Van Gogh pulled up here. Oh, there we go. There we go. Look at this guy. Boom.
There we go.
Do we look similar? Let me see here.
Oh yes, yes we do.
Yeah, I guess you're right. I do got a little bit of a Van Gogh thing going on.
It was awesome.
I'll take that. I'll take that all day.
I hope that's a compliment, by the way.
Yeah, of course that's a compliment.
Never want to insult.
The man is amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's fantastic.
But please,
I love it.
For an audio engineer, I don't need you going and cutting your ear.
No, that will not be happening.
You'll still mix the best band in the world, but you'll have one ear less. That's okay, because you just stand this way.
Yeah, exactly, man.
I don't need to look at the show.
Right? I got all my computers and microphones and everything to tell me what's going on
anyways.
Genius. Yeah, that's funny, man.
Yeah.
No, it's fun. It's fun over there, man. And I can probably pull this up too for the Area 15 thing over there with the Van Gogh experience. It's a total blast though working with those guys, man. I mean,
Let me tell you something. I don't suggest the axe throw if you're taking your wife.
Yeah, or if you're taking any extracurricular.
Extracurricular, no extracurricular, and no wives with knives.
No wives with knives.
The axe throw.
Yeah, it's a trip over there though. I'm really honored to be doing that kind of work and something like that, man. I think it's like one of the it just won like a best art installation in the world award or some crazy thing like that. Yeah,
incredible.
So yeah, it's fantastic. Everybody should definitely at least take one night to go check it out.
It was fun seeing you at Rockstar Bar.
That is a fun place to be.
I wasn't expecting to see you there that night. We went to go see a couple bands, and I was just rocking and rolling out there, and I'm like, I smelled blood. I turn around and go, there it is. They were having a rough night that night, but then you know what? You know what happened? You put your hands on it.
Yeah, I got it going real nice now, man.
That's amazing.
I think it was just, like I always say in the business, man, we're doing rock and roll, not rocket science. And sometimes people think that they're rocket scientists when all they got to do is, you know, plug the left into the left and the right into the right.
You know,
and
I needed to hear that. I think I needed to hear that. I'll tell you about that why later, but I'll need to. That's good to hear. Yeah, it's not rocket science.
No.
It's just rock and roll.
Yeah, I always take that attitude with everything I do now, man. It's not, no, I'm not doing anything special. I'm just turning up microphones, making shit loud. I love to make shit loud.
Yeah, you do.
It's fun.
It is.
You know, but it's like you got to let go of all that like technical overthinking.
Yeah.
Because we can definitely, especially engineers, I love when something's wrong.
Right.
And there's so much information in our heads. And like we're trying to troubleshoot the problem from like 45 different angles.
While some guitar player is like...
Yeah.
just shredded. Yeah. Singer's hanging off the ceiling and you're just like, we got a problem here. We got to fix this.
Yeah. And you're tracing down all kinds of crazy things and it's just like, oh, you just forgot to push this one button or right. this cable just needs to be swapped out. But you're like, no, there's like this grand illusion of insane complications that we're going to start from. Break out all the testing equipment and we're going to figure this thing out. And it's just like, oh, you mean just that right there?
Yeah.
Wow. Okay.
The now it's fixed.
Yeah. It's but we overthink everything as engineers. It's fun to, it's funny to make fun of us that way because it always happens.
Geniuses. You know? Bastards.
So, yeah. Freaking, but no, I love doing the Rockstar Bar.
Yeah.
I just started doing a Sunday Latin night over there.
Yeah.
By the way, come down and learn how to do Latin dance. They do, there's all instruction and everything on Sunday nights. And
that's
then,
crazy.
Yeah, it's Latin DJ,
you know,
Latin
I remember
band.
Back in Long Island at the Crazy Donkey, they do something on Sunday night. They do like rock and roll up until like 8 o'clock and then turn it over on a Sunday night to like, you know, Latin night, you know, and do something interesting. So it was pretty cool.
Yeah.
Squeeze the people in there. It's a great place. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah.
And you can hit golf balls out there too. Much cheaper than Topgolf. I could tell you that much.
Oh, yeah.
Jeepers, creepers.
It's fun. And they got that van in the middle out there.
Yeah.
You know,
whack the van.
Whack balls at the van.
Exactly.
Try to take the window. I think all the windows are pretty much taken out by now.
Oh, they're taken. Yeah.
Yeah.
I remember when there was pictures of president up there. President. Ex-president.
Yeah.
I was like... You motherfuckers. It was fun.
Yeah.
No, I tried to hit it too. It was fun.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
That's funny. Yeah, it's it's a great place, man. And we were out there watching a few of these youngsters whacking balls, man.
Sure.
And they had like the little mini drivers.
Oh, yeah.
They were freaking getting it, man.
Oh, yeah.
It was impressive. But, you know, family-friendly time, man. It's a great place. And it's getting better and better as it goes along.
Yeah.
So, I think I'll be there doing, I got Peter Dallas's band coming up.
Excellent.
And so I love seeing Peter. He's
sure.
He plays in like
rock
every
star.
Friggin' band out there.
What a rock star, man.
Yeah.
He just got
drummer.
It. Yeah.
Yeah.
What'd you say about the drummer?
I said he's a fantastic drummer, Peter
Dallas.
That's
right.
Yeah.
You know, he reached out to me. He said he was doing sessions.
Is he?
Yeah. He was reaching out to people and letting them know that if they needed a session. So shameless plug for Mr. Dallas.
Yeah.
If you need a drummer, he's looking for a gig.
He can play anything.
Oh, he's really good. Yeah. Yeah.
So
there's a lot of good drummers in this town. That's the problem.
Yeah.
Is that there's always good drummers. They're all good. You bastards.
Especially like with the Bluegram group being in town, man.
Oh, my goodness.
So many amazing bands come out with Blue Man members in them out here. So
what a force to be reckoned with.
Yeah. You ain't lying, bro.
I wanted to play drums, but my parents were like, no drums.
Yeah.
In the house, no drums. I'm like, Mom, you don't understand. Imagine all the shit I would have released in my life if I became a drummer.
Yeah, it's easier to write.
I would have been so angry. I would
have
been so pissed off.
Oh, that part too.
Right? I would have got it out. But they were like, shut up. I'm like, play. They were like, play guitar. It was no instrument, nothing but drums. But I wish I had drums.
I use drums for that exact reason, man. Like if I'm a little I'm a little worked up or something like that, I'll put some punk rock on, and I'll just beat the hell out of some skins.
Sure.
And I just have a really good time.
I was playing the electronic drum kit at a party about 2 months ago. We were rocking over out. I can't remember where we were, but everybody just wanted to hear a live band. You know, there was enough rock and rollers in the house. We could have done something, but we were lazy. I might have been lazy. I don't know what happened. But all I remember doing was getting on the electronic drums and kicking out the jams.
Yeah.
Boy, did I mess my hands up. I was beating the shit out of these drums. And I was like, the next morning, I'm like, dude, calm down. It's just an electronic drum set, man.
Yeah, it sounds big no matter how hard
relax,
you
hit it. Relax, bro. I'm just like, boom, boom, boom. I'm like, dude, calm down. You know, drums are good.
Yeah, I love my my Roland TD-25K behind me. That's a fantastic drum set. I play it all the time.
It's got the big rock drum arena sound in it.
Oh, yeah.
Stock.
Oh, it's got some huge sounds in it. Huge. And it also has some fun, like, percussion stuff. So, like, when I'm working on a tune or something
that,
and I need, like, you know, good sounding percussion instruments, I don't have to go get the instrument. I can just pull them up on the brain there and just I get a stereo image of some nice kungas or some bongos and stuff like that, you know, whatever you need.
I love the weird sounds they produce, you know, the zoinks and the boinks and everything like that.
Oh, yeah. That's just great.
Yeah, man.
That's just super fun to write with. So, yeah, I gotta get back in the practice of writing music again, man.
Oh,
I got the studio up. I got the podcast running on autopilot, and it's like it's time to start getting back to making music.
It is. I'll tell you, good friends, and I know you know this, but good friends like yourself, you know I've been struggling with this music. I made a couple investments. I put money into the guitar. I redid my whole Les Paul.
Oh, really?
All right. And I never thought I'd ever do this to my Les Paul because it has stock pickups. It has the stock everything inside the electronics. And I just never wanted to do it. But something was missing. I needed some inspiration. So I went out, gutted the whole thing, put brand new pickups in it, brand new electronics, brand new bridge, knobs, the whole nine yards, frets. So I'm putting some money in because now I'm putting my money where my mouth is.
Yeah.
So Stoner Dude hit me up. We're going to be doing some stuff.
Oh, he's great.
He's great. With Mary, of course. Mary Crea.
Oh, really?
Of course.
Oh, she's an amazing singer.
They're business partners in rock and roll. So,
But
I'm looking forward to doing some stuff with that. That's not the main thing on my plate, though. Main thing, I don't know if I've told you, but I'm working with an AC/DC tribute band.
Ooh, who you got singing?
Joe, forgive me, Joe. I've only known you for so long, but I don't remember your last name. I could look it up, but great. Let me tell you something. It's incredibly hard to do Brian Johnson. There's only one guy I know who could really do Brian Johnson, and that's Brian.
Yeah,
and I don't know him. But Joe is on vocals, and Ryan Gillian, I'm so sorry, my friend.
Yeah.
He's, you know him from High Voltage. Remember High Voltage?
The drummer.
Yeah, so High Voltage has taken a new route. We are coming out. I'm officially announcing the new name of the band.
Oh, really?
Yeah, this is the first time anybody's ever heard of it.
Oh.
LVDC.
LVDC. LVDC.
I had a funny concept. I'm going to blow your mind right now. And God bless Ryan. I love Ryan, and I love Joe, and I love Graham. These guys, Graham is the bass player, and we're working with Jeremy Vareo.
I know Jeremy.
Yes.
I'm actually in the process of getting him to come on. We've been talking about coming
he's
on.
He's probably got a ton of shit to talk about. He's got a lot of. He's a smart mass hole. He's got the mass hole tattoo on him, man. He's from Massachusetts.
Really?
Yeah, he's
that.
Got the mass hole. He's crazy. Talented musician. Very, very, very good band. Ryan, Joe, Graham, and Jeremy, and myself. And obviously, I'm taking on the role of Angus Young.
Big role, but
let me tell you something. Everybody's like, yeah, AC/DC's easy. But let me tell you something.
No.
It's not easy.
No.
There's a lot to be going on there. You know, it's just like Jimmy. It's just like Ace. It's just like Rick. It's like anything I've ever tried to emulate the Gemini in me, even though I'm an Aries. I'm trying to emulate it. You know, I'm trying to like, it's been tough. You know, like sometimes like, I'm like, oh my God, I can't believe what I'm getting myself into. I got to put this up for 90 minutes. I got to jam that stage. And I know I've got it. There better be a big line of beers there for me to get me through that show. But I've got it. I'm going to jam through this thing and bop my head. But the band's great. The band sounds phenomenal. We're going to be doing some stuff. And I'm pretty excited about that. I just went out and bought myself a real SG. I found in a very, very rare one. It's a 2013 Ebony Classic, like a 61 reissue. And let me tell you something. Like all SGs are like Telecasters. SGs are the Gibsons and the Fenders Telecaster, right? In my opinion, my humble opinion. And they're all fucking different.
Yeah.
And they're none alike. So this guy, like, I found this one on Reverb. And the guy's like, listen, no returns. I'm like, listen, give me 24 hours. I'll pay the shipping back. I just want to touch it. I'll pay the shipping back. He's like, no. I'm like, no. And, but like, sent them an offer. I was like, I'll try this, you know, I'll give it a try. I got it, and I'll tell you something, it's a beast. It's totally different. And so I got Rod Miller working on it right now on the guitar tech. I got him working on it, and I'm just trying to make sure it's the right one because, you know, they're all different, you know, and it's hard to find, like, the right one. I'm an OCD, ADD guitar player, you know what I mean? So I'm happy about it. We're looking forward to this. You know, it's AC/DC. It's rock and roll. The band sounds great. Really looking forward to going out and playing some shows. So we'll be playing all those rock shows and everything like that. Hopefully a little bit more.
That's fantastic news, man.
Yeah, that's a little bit, you know, it's like, I got to get out of my shell and do something.
Yeah.
You know, been in my shell a little bit. I am working on Zonked, you know, I'm very, very excited about Zonked. It's just me. And that's kind of the point of that's the struggle I have with tribute bands right now. Because, like, of course, you know, I get a lot of offers for the Kiss stuff, you know, and I just don't want to do it, you know. I swore to myself, like, never again. Like, last year, I was like, I'm never going to try to, like, be in a tribute band. And here I am trying to copy Angus Young, you know. And it's like, you know, it's exciting and fun. I do need an outlet to go out there and have some fun. And these are the guys to do it. They are world-class musicians. Very, very, very. It sounds like AC/DC. I mean, when I feel like I'm the underdog, you know, and these guys are better, I feel real good about it.
Oh, yeah.
So I need something to get out of my shell, but, you know, I'm excited about creating some new music with Kyle Frost from 4NR. So, you know, I want to get out and play. I like to be myself. It's easy to be yourself. You can do whatever you want on guitar. You don't have to stick to anything, you know, so it's exciting. But I'm excited to turn this leaf and get back into playing. So spending some money, putting some stuff in the guitars, buying some guitars, getting the tone going, working on the shit, and trying to have a better 2021.
Nice.
Yeah.
I'm really glad to hear you're getting all that done, man.
Yeah, it's exciting. It's fun.
Yeah.
I hated rock and roll for a while.
That happens.
I hated it. I was so disgusted with it.
Yeah.
And I realized, you know, I think everybody's like, come on, dude. Just get up there and have fun, you know? I'm depriving myself. I'm depriving a lot of people who like to dance and have a good time, you know? Because I don't take it that seriously, you know? That's why the Angus thing is perfect for me. Because I said to them, you guys better have a fucking stage enough for me to fucking bop from this way to that way. Because I'm moving all show. I'm going. and the singer, God bless his heart, like, four rehearsals, he's like, are you going to move? Are you gonna do the moves? I'm like, of course I'm gonna do the moves. Just hold on, we got this. Let's get to the show. I like people. Once you put people in front of me, my ego starts flaring. You know, I get to have a little bit of fun, show and tell.
Yeah,
I like to have fun on stage. That's just really what I'm saying. You know, I like to have fun. I want to get back to having fun. I want to enjoy it. I think everybody in this town wants to get back to it. Whether you're a working musician or if you're just an artist, you know, just get back there and have fun and do what you love to do, you know? Don't hold back.
That's fantastic. I really look forward to seeing the new version. I know the old High Voltage was incredible.
Incredible.
Ryan's a fantastic drummer.
Yes.
And I know you're an amazing guitar player.
Hardly.
And Joe was the singer still when it was High Voltage, right?
Yes. Yeah. Yes, he did. Right. So he was there at the night we were hanging out at Rockstar Bar. I don't know if you saw him, but that's funny because, like, he told me he was going to see, I was on my motorcycle because they couldn't find a guitar player or anybody that wants to do it or commit to it. I don't know. There's got to be another Angus Young in this town.
Yeah.
But, like, he's just like, we were drinking at the bar. He's like, you play. And he was talking to Jeremy on stage, which he was in Kiss makeup doing a show. And he's like, I can't believe this. I can't believe I found the Malcolm in the Angus. And he's like, can you do the moves? And my wife just busts out laughing in his face because, like, he's obviously never seen me on stage, like, have a good time, you know?
Yeah.
Like, make room, hold my beer, let's go, you know?
Oh, man.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, definitely hit me up when it's going. I'll put LVDC in a good word for you over at Rockstar Bar, get you guys up there playing real fast. And I don't know if the stage will be big enough for you to do the full Angus.
We got
to
build a catwalk.
They were talking about doing an extension off the stage and getting it a little bigger. And
hey, you know what I love about AC/DC?
Huh?
No backup vocals.
Yeah.
Oi. That's all I have to do. Oi.
Yeah.
I hate, as a guitar player.
And you don't even have to do that part.
I don't even have to, but you know they're going to make me. Yeah.
Well, that's Malcolm and...
Yeah, I think Angus does it.
God, yeah.
Cliff.
Cliff.
Yeah.
Ah, Cliff.
But they put out this microphone for Angus, right?
Yeah.
That's the only time they put out the microphone. I'm just like, he's so crazy. And then, like, I was so afraid of Thunderstruck. My whole life, like, forget about, like, you know, Eddie Van Halen, you know, because I would never attempt Eddie Van Halen. It's just not my dig.
Yeah.
Jeff Duncan, I'll leave that to you, brother.
Yeah.
But... Angus Young, I mean, Thunderstruck, it's one of those songs in my whole life. I've just been a afraid musician my whole life. I'm just a big pussycat, you know? I'm just like, I'm afraid to try this. I'm afraid to try this. And then when I get into it and I learn it, I go, oh my God, I can't believe what I was missing my whole life, you know? It's just a fun song to play. It's doing the little Scottish riff, you know?
I love that song, man.
And let me tell you something. We were down at, Downtown Fremont Live?
Yeah.
We were waiting for Cheap Trick to come out. And Shanti and I think we were right up in front stage. We're a little bit of VIP, I think. Thank you, Burner. but they played Thunderstruck right before Cheap Trick went on. Mm. And the bass frequency coming out of that, it was so loud, it had my wife in tears. It was so loud. I mean, on a real super system, like that bass and that mix in that song is so supersonic. It's disgusting. It can kill you. It's amazing. It's a weapon. It's a weapon of mass destruction.
Now I'm going to have to put on Thunderstruck when I'm tuning a big PA with some subs in it.
Dude, let me ask you a question. Because, like, do you ever use Steely Dan?
Oh, yeah. That's okay. My go-to, man.
So that's like...
The hi-hat and...
It's like it's every perfect. Great sound man's go-to.
That's because they did such a phenomenal job mixing those records, and
isn't
everything
it wild?
Has its place, and they do this beautiful thing with the stereo imaging of it all, you know, and no, it's perfect for tuning the PA.
If you're a future audio engineer out there, Steely Dan,
yeah,
that's what you want to play. And I would like to give props to you and George Marshall, Twisted Sister Soundman. I loved hearing it when he played it, and Night Bob. From back in the day, Night Bob, Aerosmith, Rock and Roll, Jesse Camp. I mean, all the great soundmans. Every time I go into a place, even random places, and I hear guys blasting Steely Dan, I go, "Oh, tonight's gonna be a rock and roll night."
You got to do it.
It's got to be done.
Yeah, we've been doing. Like I said, we were at Area 15. We've been doing a bunch of install work and stuff.
And you used it.
And I was like, "You guys aren't gonna play Steely Dan through this, man. What are you doing?" And so, you know, it's me and my brother and our buddy Anthony over there doing this big install.
Yeah.
And and I put the Steely Dan on, and they had to admit, like, okay, I get why you're using this, because we do a lot of like different music, you know, certain like there's certain country songs you put on that have really great presence, and a lot of like EDM music that really slaps the subs and really hits the horns hard.
Wow.
And so you can hear like the frequency range of everything, but that friggin' Steely Dan, man, it's beautiful. And
you've
when
evolved
it's right,
with the music, you've got different music now.
Yeah.
That's great.
So there's a lot of fun stuff we put on.
Right.
But, you know, when it's right, it's right. And Steely Dan will tell you if it's right or wrong.
Right.
And I always know that my horns are dialed in perfect based on the level of the hi-hat. I've been using the same Hey 19 by Steely Dan forever. And I just know what that sounds like, what it's supposed to sound like when the PA's dialed in right. And that's really a thing, you know, when you're doing that kind of stuff is you get accustomed to a specific song. It doesn't have to be Steely Dan.
Yeah, sure.
It's just a good option because the sonic clarity is so perfect and precise in it that it's a great reference track.
But Iggy Pop might not work.
Yeah, something a little too heavy. But it's good to put that stuff on too and really see what hard, heavy music's going to sound like when it comes out of the speakers as well, because you're going to be playing that kind of stuff, right?
Yeah, sure.
So,
have you ever been to CBGB's in New York City?
I haven't been to New York City.
So I'd like to just express to you that from what I remember, what I was ever told, I mean, boy, I tell you, what a great sound system.
Yeah.
In CBGB's, the worst floor ever, it made cobblestone in England in the 1600s look like, you know, paved highway in Las Vegas, you know?
God.
It was disgusting. But And the smell, Jesus Lord. But that sound system was beautiful. So great rock and roll venue. Yeah, great sound system.
I definitely want to check it out if I ever, when I end up in New York City, not if. I got offered a gig to fly out there, but sure. I was already doing something else and I wasn't able to. It was really hard to turn down that trip to New York to get paid and go mix out in New York. But yeah, I couldn't do it, man. And damn. You know what's funny? It was because I was playing my game. I've been waiting for this huge tournament, this national tournament. I play Magic the Gathering. I'm such a nerd.
Wow.
And I was like, I'm not, me and my buddy have been waiting for it forever.
Yeah.
And we went and competed in a national tournament and it was worth it. I still really? Am like, I could have gone to New York but the memories that I created with my buddy and getting to play that game on that level. Dude, yeah.
Games are the best thing ever. I know what I'm totally getting you for Christmas because your birthday just passed. Happy belated.
Oh, thank you.
Maybe it'll be a July 4th gig, birthday or something like that. I just love games, board games, any kind of games. Me and my brother would be in the basement or wherever we were. We just flop a penny or flop the bottle caps and make a game of it or do anything with games and just competition and obviously poker and cards and everything like that. And I don't know what it is, but competition with games is just the funniest thing. It could be comical or endearing, you know. I just love it.
It's a blast, man. It is a blast. Yeah. You know, I mean, that's what we're here doing. We're here playing this big game called life. It's, you know, not to be taken seriously.
Yeah.
And it's like, you know, playing all these interesting side quests with video games and board games and card games. It's like, it's the spice of life that makes it real interesting. I really love it.
Yeah.
I'll do all of it, man. The D&D and poker, and, you know, video games, whatever.
Of course.
It's a blast to really get involved in.
Yeah. So the game I'm going to get you, I'm just going to blurt it out because I just want to talk about Payday. You remember Payday?
I don't remember Payday, but I'm going to type it into my search engine.
Great family story going down memory lane. Payday was a great game because it's about a monthly cycle, like kind of like, you know, Monopoly, or, you know, you go around, of course, you go around. What else do you do on a fucking board? Sorry's good too, but Payday, it was just the family, you know, the core five, me, my two brothers, and my mom and dad, we played this game a lot, and we always played it to Carole King Tapestry. And like, are you familiar with that album at all?
I'm not, okay, actually. So you're blowing my mind over here, bro.
Carole King Tapestry is probably my top five albums. And it's tough because five is tough. But Jesus Lord, Tapestry by Carole King. Great, beautiful album. Do you know that Carole King wrote a song for the Beatles?
Really?
And
what song?
The Beatles, I apologize, I can't remember it. But the Beatles, imagine the Beatles being like, no, we don't, I mean, they're going to do a cover, rock and roll and stuff like that, you know, and they're going to do all their other covers and shit like that, which were main hits for them and the shit they loved. But somebody wrote a song for them? That's bullshit. They like Carole King, I mean, they loved it, you know. You'll probably find it once you're searching. Carole King wrote a song for the Beatles.
But I was looking up the Payday. Stuff of Payday here.
Oh, Payday is great.
Boom.
The greatest game. It's so super cute and super fun.
Some of the cards.
The cards. So you got to pay like the bills during the month and you got to pay your mortgage and, you know, you get hit with stuff during the month, like, oops, you know, water busted, and you basically just got to be the one in the money. And you know, my brother, my oldest brother is the one, the bastard who's like cheating the whole time. This has been his MO every time I bring up Payday. He's gonna hate me for this. He cheats at everything. Let me tell you a classic story, and I know he's pissed off right now because I'm having a memory right now. All right, so I'll finish up Payday. All right, great game. Played it with the family. Beautiful album.
Yeah.
Okay.
I look forward to playing it with you soon.
It's great. So we're playing this. We used to have these legendary poker games at my brother's house back in Long Island, Valley Stream. And it was, we played like every Saturday night. It was like an easy game, you know, but it's the family. We're all competitive. We're all crazy and out of our minds. And we're, of course, the game's like $20, right? But then it turns into like, you're already in for like $100 by the end of the night because it is just too much pride and too much fun. Anyway, by the end of the night, me and my brother go heads up, right? And there's a lot of money in the pot. I mean, there was like eight people playing, and there's like $800 in the pot. That's a lot of money.
Yeah.
And no one gives a fuck about your feelings in poker in my family.
No.
Nobody gives a shit, right? And nobody's like, there are no bargains. There's no nothing. There's cutthroat from day one, from the can one. Nobody gives a fuck, and I love it. And I'm one of them, too, of course. So we go heads up. And the game's over. He beat me, right?
Yeah.
Well, he beat me heads up. And it's like 3 a.m. Wife's to bed. Mom and dad are going. Everybody's going. It's just me and him. And I look down on the floor. And the king of spades is on the floor. And I go, well, how long has it fucking been there? He goes, I don't know. I go, well, then let's split the pot. We don't know how long we've been playing with 51 cards.
Yeah.
Instead of 52. And we, and of course, me and my classic brother, Warchillak, we just go nuts. We start, and the table goes flying.
Oh, no.
The chips go everywhere. I'm out of there. We're just yelling, finger pointing. It was hilarious. We can laugh about it now, of course. And I know he hates me bringing up the story, but it's beautiful. And, it's just how Warchillak poker was, you know?
Yeah.
It's like, you know, I'm coming after you, you know? Coming after you large. So we try to use that, you know, of course, in the real world, in the real poker game, but cutthroat. Cutthroat everything. Cutthroat sorry, cutthroat payday, cutthroat monopoly, whatever it is. Whatever it is, I'm coming after you.
Monopoly always gets cutthroat.
Oh, you have to.
That's like the worst game to play with friends. Like, you know, you're hanging on to property and you're refusing to trade for unless
yeah.
it's something ridiculous. And, you know, it's just like the game's never going to go anywhere if nobody gives an inch here.
Yeah, you're trying to do like time limits. You know, it's fun to do like time limits with Monopoly. At least there's an ending there. But like, I think I remember one time we tried to go for like a month. You know, we just kept like doing it, whatever we had to add and stuff like that.
Yeah.
I think that's, I don't know what the longest Monopoly game ever is, but I'd like to say I wish I tried it. But I'd rather play Payday for a month rather than Monopoly. Much, much, much bigger.
Payday. I'm looking forward to checking out Payday,
cute,
man.
Cute and funny. We'll put on some Carol King.
Yeah, that's awesome. And then, yeah, the Carol King, actually, it says here.
Yeah.
And, you know, I'm just reading off the internet, so who knows if this is right. Correct me if I'm wrong. But it says Carol King never actually wrote a song by the Beatles. They covered her song Chains on
the Please Me
LP.
Okay.
And they also played live. They played Keep Your Hands Off My Baby and Locomotion.
Okay, so now that's interesting because from what I remember Peter Asher, which I love Peter Asher. Do you ever hear of Peter Asher? I think Peter Asher was in, oh my God, I'm so stupid right now. I'm on the spot here. I'm sorry. he was in a famous band, right? But he was very, 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 very close with the Beatles. Paul McCartney dated his sister, right? So by Peter Asher had like the first listen to Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts, right? He had the first time Paul McCartney came over home to their house where he lived with Peter Asher. He played him the pressing for fucking Sgt. Pepper's.
That's amazing.
It's fucking unbelievable. But Peter Asher tells the most incredible stories about the Beatles. And I'm sorry to throw you under the bus, Peter, but I could have swore you said that she wrote Chains for them. But yeah, you're probably right. They covered it, but I know they
were sort of the same thing,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, I know they respected it. And I know I heard it once. I swear to God, I'm going to find it to you. I'm going to put it on the comments wherever I find it. I'm going to show you where I found this story.
Yeah.
Stupid Keith.
Oh, man. Yeah, I'm looking at Peter Asher right now.
Yeah. Oh, God.
It doesn't say he was in an actual band.
Yeah, he was. Peter Asher, famous band. God, I'm so bad. I'm sorry. Sorry, that's actually a thing. What's up, Maddie C. in Australia? I'm a big fan of Ali Bilala.
Oh, no, he was in some interesting stuff here.
Yeah.
He was a producer. Right. He did a lot of production work.
Huh.
Linda Ronstadt, Buddy Ray.
I know that, but it doesn't say the band he was in?
It says discography as a performer, and it says some albums. It says Peter and Gordon.
Peter and Gordon. That was what it was called.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Sorry, Peter.
Peter and
Gordon.
Yeah,
Peter Gordon. There's one song.
I figured it out.
Yeah. Thank you. Oh, I'm just sunked. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Peter and Gordon, of course. But he was very, very, very tight with the Beatles, like insanely close. So whenever I get my free subscriptions from serious. Because $5 a month isn't cheap enough. Because they just keep trying to push that crack on me, $5 a month serious. But I'm like, no, I got this, yeah. I got that. I got too many subscriptions.
Yeah.
Enough with the subscriptions. My goodness gracious.
I know, right? And now it's getting into all your digital audio workstations.
Oh,
and I'm paying for Adobe. And, you know, I was even talking to the DJ the other night, and he's saying that Serato's charging him subscriptions for Serato.
They got smart.
That's ridiculous.
So now let me ask you a question. So wait, you guys are getting smart? With all this software and all this like subscription, whatever it may be, media, but you can't protect music?
Yeah.
You can't find a way to fucking stop fucking reproducing music so people can keep sharing it and shit like that? Give me a fucking break, man.
Yeah. It's I think they've just given up on it, man. It's kind of at the point where, and like, and now, like, I mean, I have a Spotify subscription, and I have to have it for work because I constantly just get asked at the last minute, like, hey, play this song right now.
Yeah.
And so I was like, that's the only way to really accomplish that task. You used to bring hard drives around and shit like that. I have, you know, just ridiculous catalog of music, but it was never the song that I needed was on my hard drive usually. And you don't even need that anymore. You got Spotify.
But everybody tells me to get Spotify, and I'm like, I'm just so addicted to fucking Apple.
Apple Music is supposed to be pretty much the same thing, right?
Totally not as broad as Spotify.
Oh, really?
There's no way. There's just way deeper shit on Spotify.
It's pretty eclectic.
I probably need to give it a try, because my brother all the time, he's just like, are you crazy? He's like, and even my nephews are like, are you dumb?
Yeah.
You know? But I'm like, I don't know. I stick to my shit lately. My albums.
It's a game we play. We always go, I wonder if it's on Spotify. Right. And it's almost always on Spotify.
Wow,
it's like,
you must be going deep.
Crazy ass, like, live Captain Beefheart albums and shit. You know, we're looking up and we're like, there's no way that's on Spotify. Right. And there it is. And so they have a pretty deep library going.
Very broad.
Yeah, it's super impressive. And then it's, you know, it's great because then discovering new artists is fantastic. I'm always on the discover new artist train, and then I'll listen to their discography.
Sure.
Like the first album straight through. Like whenever I was doing some work for you over at Accessibles,
yes.
And you turned me on to that acoustic artist. The singer song Mac DeMarco.
Did you like it?
I loved it.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. It's not really for everybody. Like, I'm trying to get my brother on it because, like, there's a song off of Salad Days that sounds like Julian or John Lennon, right? I was completely addicted to that from day one.
Yeah.
My good buddy Wesley Suro65, what's up, buddy? He's a guru for me in my life, like yourself. And he turns me on to great music, and he's all about hip-hop. He's very deep in 90% hip-hop. But let me tell you something. This guy knows how to show you the good stuff.
Yeah.
And it's all good. I wish I could remember the names. I'm on the spot, but there's a lot of good stuff. Most importantly, Doom. I fell in love with Doom through him. If you've never listened to Doom, it's really, really great music. He just passed away. But Mac DeMarco, we turned on to this, and we caught it off of Tyler, the Creator. Tyler, the Creator mentions Mac DeMarco in a song when we heard it the first time it came out. I was into Tyler, the Creator, too. I'm all about that shit.
Yeah.
But we heard it, so we went to YouTube, and we caught this video, and that now has like 13 or 14 million, and we caught it at 100,000.
Oh, wow.
Right? We saw it when it first came out. We were like, what the fuck? So Mac DeMarco's got great albums, really, really spaced out. He's like supposed to be indie, kind-ish, but he's like really not. It's just a whole lot of everything, you know?
Yeah.
Fell in love with it. Great story. I'm flying home from France with Twisted, and we get down to the luggage area, and I'm like, you gotta be fucking kidding me. Mac? and he's like, hey, what's going on? I go, you were on that fucking plane for 8 hours, and I could have been talking to you for 8 hours on that plane and busting your balls. And he's like, hey, I've been making a joke about it. But that's when I was like really into it. I couldn't believe it was on the same plane. Yeah. So we were getting like this. So of course we take this picture with him. It's so funny. I gotta send you this picture on Instagram. His middle finger is like wicked. Like wicked. Like it's like up here. I would have to dig really deep in my Instagram to find it. It's really, really deep in there. But like he's, you know, just like a strange human. You know what? He got into some weird shit though. His most recent shit. He's like, he has a lizard song. And you know, that whole lizard, like kind of shit. government lizard
kind of. Oh, like the lizard people kind of thing.
So he's kind of like, I'm not saying he's into the lizard shit. I think he's just pointing it out. I hope he's just pointing it out. But he's like, yeah, he kind of took a little bit different direction. But yeah, I think he's trying to like say, hey, there's some shit out there.
Dude, the lizard people thing is freaking crazy, man.
Crazy.
And I love talking to people who really are into it, because I don't know. I always come from a place where I don't know shit, man. Like,
I don't know
anything
about it.
So who knows what's real,
yeah.
You know, and what's not real and what's just, you know.
It's interesting when you hear people like, who was it that came out recently? I think it was from Smashing Pumpkins. I think he was the guy... Billy Corgan. I think it was him that came out and said some shit, and I was like, fuck, I actually believe this guy, because why? I mean, he's a pretty straight shooter, but you know, you hear these stories from these people who are like, see this like stuff, and I don't know, my wife, you know, is like, yeah, there's lizards, like
lizard people.
I'm just trying to imagine they're just lizard-ish. You know what I mean? I don't know what's going on back there, but I ain't selling my soul to nobody. You can go fuck yourself. I don't give a fuck. You know?
No, I've seen funny videos where they go, if you watch real closely, their eyelids close right. this way and shit like that.
Yeah, totally,
and you're like,
totally.
I mean, come on, that's not really happening, is it? But who knows, man? Yeah. But I'll chat it up with I have a couple buddies that are they really believe.
They go hard,
you know,
in the paint.
They go hard, man, and it's like, you know, the earth is hollow, and there's lizard people, and you know, like everybody in the government is all like, you know, they're lizard people worshiping the devil, and you know, eating babies, and I'm just like,
the blood.
Let's have a conversation, bro. You know, like, hey, tell me all about it.
You know, I don't want to give too much attention to it. I shouldn't even. It's just, oh, God. There's some weird stories.
There really are, man.
And you know,
it's like the...
I don't want to say anything. I'm afraid to talk.
Oh, man. Not me, man. I got to make things interesting on here.
You know about that Tom Hanks like conspiracy, right?
Oh, yeah, where he left the country because he's a pedo, man. I mean, what are you going to do, right? Like, I mean, obviously, there's a lot of them out there. Some of them, you know, it's... Who knows who's actually those fucking pedos and who's not, but...
not comfortable.
Yeah, he's not coming back, is he? He's just staying in, what, Australia? Something like that. He got citizenship, and he got the fuck out of here whenever everyone was getting wrapped up in that business.
I don't know.
And
it just freaks me out.
Yeah, I mean...
Chill, it makes me... Ugh.
The Epstein thing, right? Ugh. Like, I mean, they had all those names, and that was really... Did you watch the documentary on the Epstein thing?
I think I made a peek to a little bit when my feed was watching it. I think, you know... I'm not a detail-oriented guy. I'm kind of like in the moment. I try to be in the moment, but I don't remember shit. I'm like, yeah, did I watch it? Yeah, kind of, sort of.
Right. Well, the reason they were blackmailing people.
Sure.
You know, they were blackmailing people, and they wanted to get shit on everybody so that they had everyone in their pockets.
Right.
And I think sometimes, like, I even heard some stuff like about... if they want to be part of the club, we got to get pictures of you with this little kid and shit like that.
That's fucking bizarre.
Yeah, man. But then they own your ass, right? And then when they need a favor, they definitely will get that favor from you. That kind of stuff. And who knows who the fuck's involved in all that? But I mean, pedophilia is a real thing. People have a lot of money. They do crazy shit with lots of money. I mean, it's, you know, everything that you can think of is possible on this planet. It's happened multiple times, more times than you can even imagine. So who fucking knows with Tom Hanks or any? I mean, I don't know shit. I don't know, you know, it's all speculation.
You know, it's hard to go to movies too these days because, like, I don't want to support some stuff.
Yeah.
You know? And, you know, every once in a while you got to go see a movie, whatever it is, you know, but I don't like supporting it really that much anymore. There's just too much going on.
There is, and a lot of people who don't know shit want to throw their opinion around like it's the end all be all, and you know, it's just like, you're an actor. Your job is to lie. Like, why should I be listening to what your opinion is about politics or the earth or anything like that? It's like, just make me laugh.
That's it.
You know, I don't care what you think.
Right.
If I want to get someone's opinion, I'll listen to somebody who's a little more educated and
through
really
the last
dives
couple
into
of
that
years
kind
of politics,
stuff.
I lost a lot of respect for people I loved.
Yeah.
People, you know, and like, you know, my wife's right. Keep your mouth shut on Facebook.
Yeah.
You know, like, especially me, I had to tone it down because, like, I'm a nobody. I'm a nobody by any means. You know, I'm just here. I'm just rock and roll. But there's one person who was just like, oh, you know, I hate to disappoint people. So yeah, I learned the hard lesson. You know, just kind of leave it alone.
Yeah.
Leave it alone. I mean,
I don't think you can get through this life without disappointing somebody, especially in today's environment where everybody's looking for something to be disappointed in. They're looking for something to be outraged by, no matter what it is.
Right.
They really want to get pissed off at everybody for any reason they can. So they'll
trigger
temper tantrum. Yeah.
Right.
It's ridiculous.
Trigger moments.
Yeah. And it's like, man, get a little thicker skin, you know? But it's like, it's fun.
Yeah.
They want to throw a fit on Twitter and like get all this attention.
Yeah.
And act like they're important for 5 seconds.
Sure.
And it's fun to just like, it's like the mob pitchfork, you know, that mob mentality where they're just like, let's all pile on this person now.
Oh,
and,
yeah.
And it's just crazy to see it all the time.
I'm kind of a ball buster, whether I be on like a hockey forum or whatever, if it was politics or musicians or Kiss. No, it's mostly Kiss. I'm the biggest wise ass in this Kiss group. It's called here I go again with my memory loss. When Kiss was like, it was like when Kiss was famous in the 70s or something like that. It's a specific group.
Yeah.
And it's pretty hardcore. Great group on Facebook. But you won't know because I can't remember the fucking name. but I always say shit like I try to trigger people because like when people spell Kiss with lowercase letters,
it
drives me nuts.
That's not the name.
It drives me through the roof. Like, you know, like, come on, Kiss is an entity.
Yeah.
Like you have there's Beso Kiss or there's Kiss. Kiss. You have to say it like that. Even when you're talking to spelling and typing out Kiss. Yeah. So I try to, I leave my ball busting shit out of there. But
they deserve the respect of the shift key.
And you know what I tell these people? It's my tagline in this group. When Kiss was, oh God, I'm still trying to remember it. We'll look it up later. I'll put it in the comments. I promise. I'll promote you. But I always tell these people, you've lost your Kiss Army credentials. And let me tell you, it gets so many likes and laughs and triggers and everything.
Yeah.
Like, fuck you, Keith. I checked out your page. You're a ding dong. Thank you, dude.
Yeah.
You know, but like, when they start talking some stupid shit, I'm like, you've lost your Kiss Army credentials. Give them back to me right now. I'll take that shit right now. I'll let you know when you get them back.
Yeah.
Mail in the mail form for $7.99 plus shipping.
I always wanted to get one of those actual Kiss Army cards, man.
I think I was too late, you know, I guess by the 80s. I guess maybe the production was really not hit by that point. But I think I drove past the P.O. box once, whatever the P.O. box was on the Kiss Army newsletter.
Oh, really?
I looked for it in California. I just wanted to see it.
Yeah.
Just this little warehouse, you know. But Kiss is cool.
Yeah, I definitely like Kiss a lot.
I know you do.
You know, that's not a secret to anybody. I really enjoyed, I got to take Angela to go see him for her first time and for their last tour.
Oh, recently, like when they were here?
The one, with the big
T-Mobile?
Circular LED walls. Yeah,
crazy,
T-Mobile.
Right?
Bro, what a great show.
What a great show. And I'll tell you what, I know I said this last show and I don't want to repeat material, but I know I definitely was like, I had to walk into that show and just go, all right, don't be a Kiss asshole tonight. Don't go in there judging. Don't worry about Tommy. Don't worry about anything. Just go in there and have a good time. And when I did that, I really let it out.
Yeah.
Because, you know, when you hear those words, hello, Vegas. It's so great.
Oh, yeah.
The beginning, the end, the fire. I mean, it's a really magical band.
Dude, I could feel the fire all the way in the back, man.
Isn't it wild?
I always get seats like behind front of house.
Sure.
And so I'm kind of far from stage, but it sounds really good. And,
you would do that, wouldn't you?
Oh, dude, I make sure I get them. I make sure I get them. That's the place to sit.
Hey, you know, I had a choice that for when I purchased those tickets. They did have something right next to the sound, and it was really good because it was also right between where Paul was going to fly out.
Oh, dope.
I should have just got it, but it wasn't really the money. I just think the side view was, I don't know why, but I thought the side view was cool this time.
Yeah.
I guess after seeing Kiss 35 times, a different view is cool.
We got to see them. I don't know if I mentioned this on the last podcast, but we got to see them at a USO show. And it was ridiculous. The USO show is like Destiny's Child and right. Kiss and Ja Rule.
Where was this?
It was in San Diego.
Oh, wow.
At Camp Pendleton.
Wow.
And we all did the Kiss makeup because I wasn't in the Marines. My friend was in the Marines, but they invited us on to go party with them. And so we were all in Kiss makeup. Nobody was in Kiss makeup.
Really?
Right? They were all just Marines partying on the beach. It was a really cool show.
Sure.
And, but when Kiss was coming on, the Marine, everybody would turn around and was like, these fucking guys got Kiss makeup on. And they go, bro, and they tap the person in front of them and they go, this guy's got Kiss makeup. And he goes, bro. And they and all the way to the front, touching the rail.
That's unbelievable.
They cleared they parted the seas for us, all the Marines at Camp Pendleton.
Way.
Much respect to the Marines. I fucking love the Marines. And, yeah, and they were, so we were on the rail for Kiss, and we got to see them front row center, fire pyro. I had a little disposable camera.
Oh, excellent.
And I should show you some pictures if I remember. Yeah. At the end of the day, I got them in a photo book upstairs,
excellent.
Man.
Excellent.
And we got some great shots of it. We got put on the screen constantly because, what else are you going to do? Show.
Sure.
And that was great. But just having all those people push us to the front row.
Yeah.
We were way in the back past the delays. And what a great experience.
I remember going, I was at a show. I know I spoke about this once. We've had so many conversations, I don't remember if it's a podcast or,
right?
or daily.
Hey, we're filling an hour or two. So
but there's this great time when we were promoting for Kiss in Philadelphia. They gave us tickets to the show, so the show comes, and we're in our seats like way back, and the four of us in makeup, like that was a cute, endearing. I was always the youngest guy, and these guys were about 6-7 years ago. New York City's Dressed to Kill, that's what we were called, because of course there was a New Jersey Dressed to Kill, and they didn't want to give up the name. It was a total rock star movie.
That's
thing.
How it goes.
They were canceling our gigs. We were fucking with them. It was beautiful. But I know we stole their props, and we took them on tour.
Oh, really?
Yeah. They had the Kill a Kiss Army banners. They were flame-proof and everything like that. And we fucking stole everything. We were like,
that's
fuck
hilarious.
You guys. We stole the horn, the lights. Psh, we're out. Good ode to Dress to Kill. So I just never forget, you're around your friends, and sometimes you think you're the only Kiss fan in the world until somebody else gets excited. And all I remember is all four of us, we just went our own way. We've somehow all four wound up in front row.
That's awesome.
But I guess everybody was when you got the makeup on, people treat you just a slightly different.
Yeah, you're there to party.
You're there to fucking rip.
Yeah.
Right? So people are like, yeah, come on, fucking sit here with me. But one of my favorite moments was when we were in Philadelphia. And I've seen Kiss front row probably twice. My favorite is 13th row, of course, because 13, but I like 13.
Go.
It's not front row. It's not front of house guy. It's not perfect sound, but it's just right. And it's a different experience because emotionally, as like this Kiss connection that I have and my endearing love for Kiss. You see these four guys on stage, and I'm having a moment where I'm just like, these four fucking guys, it was the original four, been together since the day. And it's powerful to me. It's a really powerful feeling. And you hearing the Boots on stage.
Yeah.
Hearing this between songs. And I just fucking love it so fucking much. And being so close, and the fire is hot in row 25.
Yeah.
Paul and Gene, this shit is hot up there.
And they're up there in it.
And it's a beautiful, beautiful show, really close, if you ever, could see it up close. I can't imagine what it must have been like in 76 when you were able to get that close, and they were that raw energy. You take the Stooges and MC5 fuck every other band in the world, Sabbath and everybody, and combine them with this theatrical band. Because everybody's like, I'll give credit to to Alice Cooper. I know he was really truly. I know the difference between theatrical Alice Cooper and theatrical Kiss.
Yeah,
but I always wanted to fight that argument in high school when people like fuck you Alice Cooper. I'm like, no, fuck you Kiss, man. You know,
yeah. But they're both great.
They're both great, of course. You know, I was a little late to the party with Cooper.
Yeah. I got to see him live and it changed it for me, man.
Really?
Like, I was like, yeah, Cooper's got some good songs or whatever, but I wasn't really
a
fan.
You are correct about that.
Yeah. And like, when I saw him live, man, and he opened for the Stones.
Right.
And he destroyed the Stones.
No fucking way.
Yeah. Like, yeah, it was incredible. Like, wow. He put on such a killer show. His band is super tight.
And I don't give him enough credit.
Yeah. He always like, man, I really got to start listening to more Alice Cooper after that. As he was fantastic.
You know, my wife's a really big Alice Cooper fan, and I understand why now more, but Jesse Camp was also a really big Alice Cooper fan. You know that dude I played for, right? That back in the day from MTV. And we got to open up for Alice Cooper back in 99, you know, and it was a really unique experience, you know, and it was the first time because I was just all about Kiss and Zeppelin, and I didn't really understand, like, the Cooper thing. And then when I got to really learn about it and be embodied in it with this whole thing, you know, it was a great experience. Yeah, he was... What just a gentleman. Just a perfect gentleman he is, you know. Very, very nice. We got to meet him on the tour bus at the end of the tour. You know how, like, rock and roll tours are. You don't get to meet the guys till the end sometimes.
Yeah.
You know, party with them or whatever.
Sort of like on Wayne's World when he's talking
exactly.
about the Native Americans in Chicago and everything.
Yeah. He's so soft and so just really beautiful. It's amazing. What a great career and a lot of kudos. And he's what a great rock star.
Dude, yeah, he's fantastic. I used to work... I used to run the Brick House Theater down the street from Cooperstown in Arizona.
Wow.
We were just like a few buildings over.
Sure.
And so yeah, I never really got to meet him per se, you know, but I heard a lot of good stuff and he was always, you know, courteous and everything.
Yeah. Big golfer.
Oh yeah?
Loves that golf. Man, he can go out there and play. That's why he's so tan. He's going out there playing golf all the time.
He does have that leather skin.
He does, right?
Dude, Arizona is a big golfing town, man, especially like out in Scottsdale and everything. Tons of golf courses.
Arizona itself is a whole different planet.
Yeah.
Right?
Oh, I loved it out there.
It's hotter than Vegas in a sense, right?
Yeah, it's a dry heat.
It's not quite
slogan.
A dry heat like this. You know, it's just a total different element. It's like Mars out there. It's bad.
Oh, dude. And everybody's got guns like on their hip. Like that's out here in Vegas too, right?
Yeah.
Like, you know, people carry guns on their hips, no problem. But like in Arizona, it's like the freaking Wild West. Like everybody's got a gun on their hip.
It's
man.
A little bit different.
And, you know,
everybody's bougie about it out here, but
yeah, out there, it's just, you put on your pants, you put on your boots and you put on your gun and that's how you go outside.
Wild.
And, you know how, you know, people aren't really messing around so much in that kind of an environment.
No.
You know? People were pretty well behaved.
Right.
You know,
interesting. What a concept.
Right. I am...
still behaving in Vegas. Come on.
Yeah, no shit.
Controlled.
Oh, dude. I mean, have you heard the horror stories since they opened the Strip back up? And even when they were opening it back up in COVID and all the people were coming out and just getting in fights nonstop?
I remember the wheelchair story. Do you remember the electric wheelchair story? Where young people were just renting wheelchairs.
Oh, really?
The electronic ones.
Are you talking about like the scooters?
Scooters, that's right.
At Walmart?
Not a wheelchair.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. I'm so sorry. Not a wheelchair, a scooter. You know? But they were just going in, just messing them up, going down the escalators.
Oh, my God.
But they were just, the reason why I said that is because they were taking them away from people who really needed access.
Yeah.
And certain access in certain parts of this town, which is not easy to get over a bridge. It's not easy to get up into an elevator around here. So there was a funny, not funny, but they were just abusing it, you know, to the fullest extent.
Yeah.
Yeah. So. Yeah, and I've heard the other stuff.
Everybody thinks they're in Jackass movies when they're a teenager.
Right.
And young, you know, the
movie.
The lower 20 areas, you know. It's like, yeah, I'm just going to cause a ruckus and make a huge fool of myself and do stupid shit because it's so cool and it's so funny. And it's like, yeah, it is kind of funny, though.
Sure.
Yeah. You know. But you don't catch us doing it when we're a little older. You know?
No,
you kind of get too old for that shit. And you're like,
I'm not allowed to do that stuff anymore. It's sad. Those days are gone.
Yeah, the dumb shit we used to do with shopping carts.
I mean, I laugh at the story, you know what I mean? But then it just, my reality checks in and goes, oh, man, that sucks. You know?
Yeah. Yeah, a little, you know, it's disrespectful, but it's, yeah, it's freaking ridiculous.
Hey, but hey, Vegas is open, right?
Vegas. Yeah, no, it's wide open, man. It is cracking.
Rock and roll, come on out.
There's shows everywhere.
Yeah.
The masks are gone. People are still wearing them voluntarily, but sure. They're not really, I mean, nobody's really wearing masks, so they don't have to anymore.
So I remember, I guess it was mid-May when the loosening started to happen. Yeah. Now, you know, it's easy to shit talk Sisolak. You know, it's easy to say a bad about him, which I'm guilty. But
yeah, me too.
I mean, I guess, now that we're here, you know, it's like, all right, you know, I guess at least we're doing something because, like, the NHL, let me tell you something. The Vegas Golden Knights have had the best crowds out of all the NHL teams.
Oh, yeah?
Including Canada completely closed down, like, they're hardcore. They've only got, like, 2,000 or less than 2,000 people in there. Vegas is ripping and rocking. Mm-hmm. And it's nice to see that. I just think it was kind of funny. This one time, I guess it was early May, I walked into a store and I was like, I had heard about people taking their mask off, and I didn't. I felt so fucking weird.
Yeah. And I was like, am I going to get in trouble right now?
I was like, no, you're not weird. You want to do this.
Yeah.
And I never had a problem. I went to all the gas stations. I went to all the banks. And then you started seeing the signs come off, right?
Yeah. Now it's not mandatory. It's right. Recommended.
Right.
Yeah.
It's weird. I ain't gonna lie, it's fucking weird, but I ain't for it. I'm not a mask fan.
I don't believe in it.
I think it's completely stupid. Take it or leave it, but you know, we gotta live our lives. I want your germs. Hey buddy. I want a little bit of
They're
you.
They're all yours, man.
Bring me some
whatever
shit.
You want, bud.
I want it. This is how I live.
You know, that's it, man. We're constantly sharing all of our germs with everybody, and you know, you gotta have an immune system.
Sure.
So, but you know, it's just great to be on the other side. I remember the first concert I did it at Dive Bar, and nobody was wearing their masks. Everybody was partying. The place was friggin' packed.
Right.
Because it was like, it was a little before we were supposed to be doing it, but Dive Bar don't give a fuck. And that's why I love Dive Bar.
Yeah.
And it was just, the place was just packed. The parking lot was packed. And there was like maybe three people wearing masks, and everybody was just getting rowdy and having a great time.
Wear your mask, go wear your mask.
Yeah.
I don't care.
Well, you know, who cares? You know? That's to each their own.
You know, and I like to wear a mask. I've been wearing a mask, certain types of masks, for years because when I go into the high desert and whatnot, when I'm hiking and shit like that, I like to have protection there. Yeah. But now I feel weird because I'm like, oh, somebody's looking at me thinking I'm weird, you know? I don't want to be weird. It's just the dust.
Yeah. It still makes me laugh when someone's driving in a car by themselves and they have a mask on.
That cracks me.
That's the funniest shit.
The you know what up.
Yeah.
That cracks me up.
It's like, what are you doing, bud? What are you doing?
Yeah,
you're by yourself in your car. You wearing a mask at home when you're watching TV all by yourself too?
When else are you wearing a mask here?
Yeah,
What's going on there?
Like, you know, some people were taking it a little far, man, and that shit was, it was funny, but I'm really glad it's over because, God, what a pain in the butt to just constantly be remembering. You know, I
think we're sacrificing the mask now for some other bullshit, though.
Yeah, no, people are.
This game is going on here.
Yeah, I agree. I agree that it's a game.
Somebody's
to see what
playing
how far
payday
they can
with
push
us,
it. And I mean, realistically, you know, the government's ever since what, like 9/11 happened, and they started taking away our rights and fucking with the Constitution for 20 years, they've been doing it, and they're just trying to keep on taking a little bit at a time, little bit at a time.
You know,
you're standing around going, do I even have any rights anymore? Am I allowed to, you know, they're going after First Amendment rights. They're going after Second Amendment rights. They're going after freedom of assembly. And it's just like, man, this is not cool. Everybody wants to jump on the bandwagon like, oh, this is, everything's going to be fair now. And it's like, no, you're going to be living in a dystopian communist country real fast, like, man, and
correct,
you're not going to like it.
I personally don't see, I mean, what you just said in 30 seconds scared the shit out of me.
It's happening.
Scared the fucking shit out of me. Sorry, I don't mean to curse. I know.
Please curse.
I know. You're good about it, but
yeah.
Sorry, Mama-san. Sorry, Mom. Mama-san is my wife's mother, and Mom is my mom.
Ah, okay.
So I'm sorry. I've been cursing so much. I did another podcast last week.
Yeah, you know, when you're around friends, it starts coming out.
Yeah,
like, I'm so good
out.
All day. It's just me and it, you know?
Exactly.
But then we start talking shit, and it's just like,
but
oh,
you scared
that's,
the shit
goes.
Out of me. You know, because, come on, how do we not see what's going on?
It's
you know,
plain as day,
when
man.
9/11 happened.
Yeah.
You know, I'm smart. I'm rational enough to go, oh, well, really?
Yeah.
Wait, really? This really happened?
It was pretty ridiculous, man.
And now we go 20 years later and all that shit in between and the perspective. I mean, I like to receive what people are saying and I really dig deep and I search for the black hole in life, the scary part. You know, when you really like dig deep, or whether it be meditation or hallucinogenics or just spiritualness, I go to the solar system and I scare myself because I go, well, where's the end? You know, this is an ending to me because like it's scary.
Yeah,
it's bullshit, and I don't like the way it's fucking going.
No, it's just a game they're playing to really capitalize on the system. It's just like, I mean, you know, the cost of living compared to the minimum wage in the country, and you know, everybody it takes two people having a full-time job and a side hustle
right.
to survive in this country, when it used to be one guy would go out, or girl, you know,
right.
one person would go out and get a job,
sure.
and they'd be able to support their family, man. They'd be able to buy a house, buy a car, have two kids,
sure,
and all of it would be taken care of by an average job, not a fantastical job where you have a PhD or something.
Right.
The average, you can go to a trade school and go get just a basic job and support your family with it. And now that's just completely unrealistic. They want you, and like the debt that you get put in going to a school.
Oh God.
Man, that's crazy.
Oh boy.
And it just keeps getting worse and worse and worse. You know, it's more and more expensive as it goes along. And now you're in debt. I just paid off my student debt that
wow.
I got 15 years ago. It took me 15 years and it wasn't even a lot of debt.
Wow.
And, yeah, and it's just like there's this pull, right, where they just see how much can we take from these
sure.
people, and you know they keep giving us little technological advances and everything like
subscriptions.
That. Where we're comfortable. I call them the golden chains, man. Everything's so comfortable, and it is. Everything's fantastic. It's never been this great in human history before.
Yeah.
I mean, the existence that we have right now is incredible.
Uh-huh.
And no humans on the planet have ever existed in such luxury that we get to live in as Americans.
Right.
And even today, all the billions of people around the world that still don't have anywhere near what we have.
Correct.
But at the same time, the reason we have all this stuff is because of, you know, the beauty and the freedom, the freedom to live a capitalist existence and our constitution, and all that shit's just getting shit on. And I realize I'm on a fucking little bit of a political rant right now, but it disappoints me, man.
It's disappointing. So people need to hear different perspectives.
Yeah.
People need to hear it certain different ways. It doesn't matter who it comes from. It needs to be said.
Yeah.
You know, this is our country, and this is what we were built on. And our fathers did that for a reason.
Yeah, and they put the Second Amendment into place so that you could keep the government in check. It's not because guns are cool, because guns are fun. They're cool, but that's not why we have the Second Amendment.
Right.
The Second Amendment is so we can form militias and overthrow our own government.
Sure.
That's why it's right. It's the second thing in the Constitution that they put there is we know corruption's going to happen. We know it's going to happen because people inevitably are corrupt. Power corrupts people. And the more power people are able to gain, the more corrupt they're going to become. And eventually the system's going to have to be overturned again, and we're going to have to start fresh.
Right.
And that's why you see everyone, all these corrupt politicians and people in power, slowly messing with the Second Amendment, slowly taking away your availability for like magazine sizes, ability to purchase ammunition, and you know, really trying to regulate what kind of guns you can have all
sure.
the time. And it's like, I'm the opposite end of the spectrum. I'm like, you know what, when they were writing that, we didn't have tanks, we didn't have planes, we didn't have submarines, we didn't
right.
have rocket launchers, and it's like, we should actually be amending the Constitution in the opposite direction.
Sure.
You know, people should be able to get serious weaponry so we can contend with the military that we're up against. I mean, that's
right.
a ridiculously radical point of view, but it's once there again, to overthrow the corrupt politicians. And if all we're doing it with is shotguns and handguns, we're not going to win that fight, you know? And then they're just, it's power overthrows the people ultimately. And now we don't have a government for the people, by the people. We have a dictatorship that's, you know, absorbing all the power, absorbing all the money. And we have no, and we're just losing our rights left and right. Like crazy, we're losing our rights left and right.
Wouldn't it have been way cooler to hear this in social studies?
Yeah.
Grade 7?
Oh, bro, you shouldn't have seen me in social studies. I got kicked out of social studies quite often, yeah.
I can imagine that.
Well, you know, the teachers don't read the goddamn books. That's another problem, is the teachers are fucking terrible.
Of course.
They don't get paid enough. We should be paying teachers enough to where intellectuals want to be teachers. It shouldn't be like a job that's just like a plan B for people.
Right.
Right? Like, yeah. People are like, fuck it, I guess I'll just, you know, go make, what, $35,000 a year being a teacher, if that.
With 4 months off.
Yeah, and it's like, I mean, you know, that's not really bringing in the cream of the crop to teach the next generation what's real.
Right.
And the curriculum's not teaching them what's real. And, I mean, that's a ridiculous subject in the first place, if you want to get into what's real with me. I'm fucking crazy about that. But, No, I would get in fights with, the social studies teachers. They wouldn't read the goddamn book.
Wow.
And I love reading, and I would read. They'd give me a history book, and I read history books, man. And I'd come back in, and I'd start being like, well, that's actually not the case here. And if you actually read the book you gave me, you would know that.
I wish I did that.
And they would just be like, you need to leave. You're disrupting the class. And I'm like, well, you're not teaching anybody shit here, you know? Like, this is ridiculous. It's ridiculous what we pass off as an education in this country.
Right.
So, yeah, and I'm ranting over here. I'm ranting on my own podcast.
Oh, it's going to be a big, big episode when you do one of those. Full one.
Oh, dude.
Preach.
I can,
You got a good, clear conscience and a good vision on it all, man.
Well, I love
very
freedom.
Respectful. Of course.
I love this country. I love the planet. I love everybody in
it. I don't have I'm not degrading myself, but I just don't have a good intellect like you do. You know what I mean? Like, I'm just over here like, fuck you, let's go. I want my country. That's all I
got
to say.
Well, I mean, we got such a great thing going.
Yeah.
And it's the reason we've become such a powerhouse in the world game. And like, getting rid of it and handing all the power over to the government is not going to, it's going to make things really a lot worse for everybody.
Yeah.
And it's just, and it comes from such a childish and lazy place. You know, everybody wants free shit and they feel like they're entitled to it. And it's like, you're not, man. You're not entitled to much of anything.
Sure.
You know, you definitely deserve the same respect that everybody else is given. You definitely deserve an equal chance and opportunity to grow and exist in the pursuit of happiness in your life, however you see fit.
Right.
And to practice whatever religion you want to practice, you know, and to assemble with your friends and say any fucking thing you want.
Sure.
Anything you want, man. It doesn't matter if it's not cool to say it.
Right.
It's like you just, who cares?
Correct.
You don't have to go.
It's amazing what other people in other countries don't have that freedom.
Yeah.
That they cannot say that.
Yeah.
And they get into very much trouble because they said that.
Look what's happening to the kids in China. All they're getting together and saying, we want democracy. We want to be able to vote for our leaders. We want to be able to take part in the government. And they're fucking killing them, you know? And they're hitting them with less than lethal, but they're also killing these kids. And they just don't want it to go down. They're like, no, this is, you know, inevitably what happens and what will happen to us too, man, if we keep letting it go down this slippery slope. And we let them curb our language and take away our right to defend ourselves and take away our right, our freedom to assemble as a people, man. Yeah. It's like, nah, you can't be doing that. And I know it hurts everyone's feelings like crazy fucking people like Nazis, right? That's a big one. Nobody wants Nazis to get together and say racist shit and spout their crazy theories. Mm-hmm. But it's like you can't cut anyone off from this right and this freedom.
Yeah.
You just don't go to those things, man.
Right.
You know? And most of us don't agree with that. I definitely don't agree with that propaganda bullshit.
Of course.
That ideology that anybody's better than anybody else. That's, you know, especially based on skin color. How stupid is that? But you know what? I'll be damned if you take away anyone's right to be able to do that.
Sure.
Because the second you take it away from them, now no one's really allowed to do it, man.
Nope.
The second you're not allowed to say one word, now everybody's going to pile on and be like, well, what about this word and this word and this word and this word and this word? And it's like, it's what's happening with our guns too, man. They're fucking our gun rights all up. And
our cartoons.
And our cartoons.
Leave my cartoons alone, please.
Yeah.
I don't want my cartoons edited or removed, or that one episode in the season of whatever show it was because you couldn't show that.
Yeah. Pepe Le Pew is a racist, right? Or no, a rapist. A rapist, right? He's a freaking cartoon skunk. It's just like, yeah, I mean, people thought differently. You know, look at Archie Bunker from All in the Family. That show was hugely popular, and he was racist, and he was sexist, and it was like, well, those were the times. We all know that's not okay behavior now, but you can't just erase it from history like it never happened, man.
Correct. Right.
You know, there's a reason we teach about World War II and the Nazis in school. Mm. You can't just let that happen again. And if we aren't aware that these kind of steps, you know, they progress into this kind of insanity, and it'll just keep happening. And people, you know, they'll drive that train right into the fucking station and start loading whatever group of people, you know, like they did with the Jews, right onto the trains. And it's all over, and it'll happen again and again and again. The fucking communism thing, man. I mean, what? Communism's killed over 100 million people. And people are out here in America living in a capitalist system, which is, you know, it's not the best system in the world, but it's pretty fucking good for what we got going on for ourselves. And they're demanding a system they've never existed in.
No.
They've never existed in it.
That's because it's good for them.
Yeah. And it's like, it's going to be terrible for everyone.
Oh.
And
a very daunting feeling.
Yeah.
Very scary.
It's fucking insane that people would want to do a system that's failed constantly, over and over. All it does is destroy the country, kill millions and millions of people. And they're just like, well, this time it'll be different.
Oh, yeah.
What?
You hear about those stories of people, like, see random videos of people that used to live in Venezuela.
Yeah.
And they're like screaming at us. And you know, this one video, even though there might be 500,000 views on it, it's not enough. They're like, please listen to me. Please, please fight back. Please do not let this happen.
Yeah.
You are going to regret this.
It's insane that anybody would actually, and it's just people that don't really comprehend what they're actually asking for.
Sure.
I get the, it's that righteousness of like everything, everybody should be equal and everything should be fair. And it's like, well, everybody is equal. We start out, we have the same opportunities presented to us, regardless of what your perspective is on that, man. I mean, nobody's stopping you from pursuing your dreams in this country.
Right.
And if you're skilled, and you make yourself a tool to be utilized by people who have money for you, they will utilize you.
Correct.
There's no, you know, the inherent racism in the system. It's not the 50s anymore, man. Yeah. And so many laws have been passed to prevent that kind of behavior from happening. And people act like that's still running rampant, and it's just not. But no one's going to have it fair. Fair has never happened in the history of life.
Right.
Like, existence in general is not fair. It'll never be fair, and you can't make it fair.
No.
It's not supposed to be.
Monopoly's
not fair.
Poker's not fair.
Yeah.
Life's not fair.
We're playing a game. Right. It's a game. Hustle.
Hustle.
Go out and play it.
That's right.
Don't sit around and ask for someone else to play the game for you and make your life fair comparatively, which is ridiculous. I mean, where are we going to draw the median at, you know?
Right.
If everybody's going to have the same thing, what is that same thing? And where does it come from? Who's actually going to go out and work and make it happen?
Scary.
Yeah, so.
Very deep, dark road. It's very scary. Yeah. I wish it on no one.
No. I mean,
so take back America, baby.
Yeah, and I'll stop ranting about it because I realize I've gone quite a tangent.
It's it needed to be heard. So take it from here. Needs to be heard. So I'm glad you said it.
Yeah, I mean,
you have a much, much profound way of saying things. I'm just like, fuck you.
Yeah, you know, and people want to. Yeah, it's. I agree with their sentiment and their heart.
Yeah.
Where they want everybody to have you know, this beautiful life, but it's like, I mean, if you're already in America, yeah. you're fucking winning.
Sure.
You're winning so hard.
Oh,
and
my goodness, are you?
It's like, go try to live somewhere else for a week.
I remember
see how
people
that,
I
see
knew
how that
used
goes.
To shit on America, you know. And I'm like, you know, I've traveled. I've seen some shit.
Yeah.
Not the worst shit. I've seen some shit. And, you know, it's like, you really can't beat it out here. It's
no.
a beautiful, beautiful border. You know, make it beautiful, keep it beautiful, do your job, work hard.
You'll get ahead.
You'll get ahead. You know, you might not get what you want, but you get what you need.
Yeah.
You know, that's the beautiful part, you know?
I mean, it's a country where everybody has the same story. My grandparents or my great-grandparents came here with nothing on a boat.
What a different story.
Yeah, and here they are, you know, generations later, and they're just living this fantastic life that they, you know, that we, you know, are calling privilege now, which it's definitely, if you live in America, you're privileged, man. You got it fucking made compared to most people.
Absolutely.
Compared to damn near everybody's ever existed, pretty much. And yeah, and obviously it's not perfect.
Yeah.
But what is perfect, man?
Let's keep what we got good.
Yeah.
Please.
And I'm gonna switch it to a different tangent because look what I found.
What'd
we were talking
find?
About. Boom.
Look that at the size of that finger.
That guy's middle finger is an alien finger.
That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah. So that was you with Mac DeMarco at the airport.
That's in the international baggage area before you go through customs.
Yeah.
So he's just standing there, and I'm just like, I see the backpack on him and the cap, and I'm just like, you got to be fucking kidding me. Now, like, I know he's playing in Vegas a couple weeks later. I know that the guys that I work with are going to shit, you know, when they see this. And the first picture they took of me, you know, being the ball bus as they are, is they cut my head off, right?
Oh, yeah.
And then they showed that picture to me. They didn't show me the good picture. So I'm glad I had that picture. It was a good memory. It was super chill, you know. Good, great music. A lot of chill music. Definitely a different vibe, you know. Not quite the Twisted Sister that I'm known for, or the Kiss or the Zeppelin, but it's great stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. Good memory. I can't believe you found that.
Yeah, I was digging for a while. You were right. It was way down
there. It was pretty
down
there,
right? It was down there pretty far, but we found it, man.
I like to post Instagram photos.
Yeah, man. Speaking of alien fingers and conspiracy theories, what do you think about all this alien shit coming out?
Let me tell you, the only alien I want to do is the alien cat house.
Right? Ooh. I've not been to the alien cat house.
Where is it? Is
Area 51?
Kind of-ish. Not really, but it's like we did a trip up to Tonopah a couple weeks ago.
Ah, I like Tonopah.
Yeah. I posted that video on Instagram. You can check that out, the Tonopah video. I've been enjoying iMovie, just like making moments in life and enjoying iMovie a lot. I love to do videos too, you know? I'm enjoying doing that. And we did this whole ride through the ghost towns in Rhyolite and a couple of the stops, the candy stop going up north. And we went to Tonopah, but way before there, on the first journey, we stopped at this alien cat house. And obviously there's a brothel and there's the superstore with the gas station. You know, the brothel's closed down because of COVID. Like they're worried about germs.
Yeah,
you know?
Right.
Usually they offer tours. I think we were tours for whores. They did not have any tours that day. And although I was chaperoned by my wife, no hanky panky, we were just out there to have a lot of fun. And we went up there and this shirt is great. I love the alien cat house, the logo. You know, so it's the only aliens I like. It's the cat house aliens.
The cat house aliens.
Yeah.
Yeah, we had the band what the hell was that band name? Now I'm gonna have to look it up real quick, I can tell you.
Yeah, I know the brain farts are the worst, aren't they?
No, Stars Unhinged came on
and
we had a big conversation about it. They were they're big alien fans. They ended up going out to Area 15 and actually getting messed with a little bit by some of the guards out in front, you know.
Have you ever done that before?
That. I haven't. I'm gonna take my dad for sure though. He's a big alien fan.
So we did it and we went all the way right up to the gate.
Yeah.
And they came out.
Yeah.
And they just stopped and they just popped up and that was all they did. We weren't messing with anything. They knew we were just being silly. But I regret, my God, anybody wants to go? I mean, I like trucks. I know you got a truck, but my bougie truck, I'm like, that was the worst thing for the dust and everything. I screwed up the filters. It's dusty out there.
Yeah.
It's really, really, it gets into like some really dusty road out there. So I screwed up my car for a little bit. But yeah, I mean, it's kind of just silly just to go out there. Everybody knows that there's this mailbox that you turn a left on. But the mailbox is like destroyed. There's like nothing in there. I don't even know what it was for. But yeah, you go down this road, you just drive down there, and there they come, you know? And the cool thing is, like, I just love that they have these microphones that they could hear everything and they're listening to everything. You know what I mean? So it's just cute to me.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I'm not really looking for anything. I did do a UFO tour up in Sedona, though, once.
Oh, really?
Yeah, that was good. That had I had a different perspective.
Oh yeah.
So like he gives the couple a pair of those, you know, military grade binoculars, right? And he gives you like a laser, you know, one of those crazy lasers. And obviously, you know, much instructions. You cannot point this at a plane.
Yeah.
Right. These high grade lasers are crazy. So he, you know, like I know what a star looks like. I know what a plane looks like. I know what a shooting or meteorite looks like. And then he's explaining these to all these people. And he goes, but I'm going to show you a space station and I'm going to show you UFOs. And I was like, all right, sell me on this. So he did show us a space station. It was bright and it was the right moment because he had proof of it. And I saw the proof that it was going over Sedona.
Yeah.
And we could see it. It was beautiful.
It like circles the globe every 90 minutes.
Of course. Bright, stagnant, right across the sky. But he goes, then you're going to see these dots that move fast. When I first saw it, I was like, oh, what is that? I was really amazed by it. And then he showed us three dots moving together. And he pointed it out. Some were moving fast. Some were moving slow. I mean, there's a lot of energy over Sedona. I mean, the things that spiritual and unidentified things that are happening over in that, like, vortex right there is really powerful. So I was pretty impressed. I give this guy a 5-star review on Yelp. It was really intense to see these things, and I definitely, you know, I see a difference. I'm not sure it's the green guy up there, but it's definitely a UFO, an unidentified flying object, and there's things moving up there, and it was really wild. I was really impressed with it.
That's cool. That's on Sedona, huh?
Yeah, yeah. He takes you into this nice little back alley, really, really dark. And let me tell you this funny story there. Of course, there's always a funny story. We were shining these lights, but I know this one guy was like shining a light. He was like pointing at everyone. And these people who were like partying, I guess in their houses, they don't like it at all.
Oh.
Even if you're pointing the lasers up, they don't like it at all. You can imagine, I mean, some purist in Sedona, you know, some real earthy people probably don't like that stuff. They don't want to deal with it, especially in their house.
Yeah.
You know, but they were yelling at us to, like, turn that shit off, you know.
Oh, God.
And the guys was just like, just ignore them. I'm here three times a night, you know. It's making a lot of money, I tell you that much. But the goggles were cool. I never seen anything like that. I mean, really, really cool military-grade goggles. You can really see some wild shit. You know, in the dark. Now I can see what the Marines are using, like when they were in Afghanistan, like this powerful shit, see, you know, to look for stuff. It's wild. You know, wish I had the balls to be a Marine.
Oh, man.
I'm a Marine in rock and roll.
There you go.
Military rock and roll. But boy, I tell you, I have such a respect for those guys who hold it out, man.
Oh, they get put through a lot, man. The Marines do. And just existing as a Marine on the base. I mean, they get those guys up before the sun and they run them rampant and they'll just take them out at a moment's notice and make them just sleep in the middle of the desert for, you know, several days. And, you know, just so they're just used to they just turn them into just savages. You know,
it's
they're
going to
really make life as miserable as they can, even when they're at home. So when they send them out, they're just like, you know, I mean, we were just doing that other shit that's way worse than this. So, I mean, this isn't so bad.
Right.
And really, it's fucking miserable where they're at, too, at that point. But they're just animals.
I was intrigued with the Air Force as a child.
Yeah?
I wanted to fly planes so bad, but I guess I didn't realize early on, the curricular wasn't there and, you know, the overall, you know, child body health. I just wasn't in that family. I didn't have any outlets to it. You know, I wasn't going into the Army or the Air Force or anything like that, but that's really what I wanted to do. I really, really want to fly like a Corsair.
Oh, yeah.
It's like my favorite plane ever. You know, the plane where the wings go like down and out. So it's not a straight wing, so it goes down and out. They're like, and then the wings fold up on the air. I think they're one of the fastest engine planes, you know, like ever. Yeah, they compete like the fastest, kind of like a Mustang plane, but these specific Corsairs are Corsair, I think, something like that. They're just beautiful planes, and oh god, do I want to fly in one of those so bad. I really, really want to get one of those because I know they're fast.
Something like this?
Oh.
Look at that thing.
Oh, that is the rock and roll plane of the Air Force.
That's pretty cool.
I mean, the Tomcats are cool. Look at me knowing plane names and shit like that. Oh, boy, I want to fly one of those.
Dude, my brother is in the Air Force now. Oh. My youngest brother, Eric, he joined. Yeah, and he loves it, man. He loves it. I wish I told him to send me the pictures. He sent some photos to my mom. He never got them to me, but he was doing this guy's last flight, this pilot's last flight, and then the crew and everything on it, they were able to like leave the bay door down in the ass of the plane where they just, you know, they let cargo loose, right. And they're all sitting on the edge of the bay door with parachutes on for the flight coming out of Miami is where it was. And he just got these beautiful pictures of him just hanging outside of a plane. I'm so proud of him. What a stud.
Wow. You know, that takes a lot of courage.
Yeah, does, man.
All chapters takes a lot of courage, but I mean, being up in the air.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
I always loved those movies, like, you know, Pearl Harbor movies and any of the war movies. I love the war documentaries and the history channels and stuff. I kind of have a secret passion for that.
Have you ever checked out Dan Carlin's Hardcore History?
I can't say I have.
Dan Carlin is he's a super fanatic about history. Yeah. And I was introduced with his Countdown to Armageddon, like, I guess, podcast or whatever you want to call it. It was like 6 3-hour episodes of him just talking about World War I.
Wow.
And the way he describes it and the information that he has and like the amount of material he's read on it. I mean, he's so passionate about it and he takes you there.
Wow.
And, but he does a bunch of, you know, he does World War II and he does even, you know, ancient wars and everything like that. And, yeah, it's Dan Carlin though, man. He does a fantastic job describing it. And World War I, I didn't even realize how, just what a crazy time that was where, like the French are still charging with cavalry, like on horses with giant feathers.
Right.
And you know, it was like still old school,
not
like
1800s,
1700s
yet.
Style warfare. And they were going after the German army, which had been preparing for this thing for a while. And they had serious new technology that was just devastating to these people. And so you have like scenes in World War I where you have old school Napoleonic like cavalry charging tanks and charging dug in people. They're digging ditches and they have machine guns.
Right.
And they're just annihilating these people.
Wow.
And it was a crazy arms race that had to happen immediately where everyone just didn't realize this is what warfare has become.
Right.
And I think you know, scary enough as that is, I think we're about to enter another one with China, and I see them getting geared up.
Yeah.
And the leaps that are going to be made with our technological advances, you know, like we're used to seeing people shooting rockets and tanks, and now that they have the drone thing, but you know they got some way heavier shit in line for when the real wars need to be fought.
Right.
And I think the same thing will start happening where just the technological advancements that everybody's been doing in their top secret bunkers are all going to come out and fucking scare the shit out of everybody.
You know, isn't it weird for me? I mean, hey, war is scary, right?
Yeah.
Right. But we also love the history of it.
It's what marks our history, right?
Right.
Like
so, I'm so interested with it, you know. Like, it's kind of hard to say in public, but I'm kind of a fan of war.
Yeah.
Okay. In a way,
I think that's human nature, man.
Right. It's my last name as well. You know, war. But I mean, the art, you know, and whether it be protection or whether it be to take over. You know, there's just such a weird, I mean, I like the history of it. I'm enamored with it. I look, you know, I study it and I'm interested with it. But of course, I don't want to go through a war.
No.
It's fucking scary, you know? That's been one of my deepest, darkest secrets is seeing this land have that war.
Yeah.
That's how lucky we are here.
Yeah, we don't get the war on our soil. You know?
That's the point.
It's we're so blessed for that.
Correct. You know, so, but yeah, I mean, I could just really talk about it all the time. It's
fascinating.
It's fascinating.
You know, that was another interesting part of the World War I thing that Dan Carlin talks about, was the glory that came with war.
Yeah.
And the, it was really a romanticized thing, you know, sure. You get to go out and become a man and on the battlefield, because it was still, up until that point, you know, it was like single fire muskets and swords and horses.
Right.
And it really was like, it still had a lot to do with character and skill set of being like a combatant on the field. Mm. And it wasn't really the level of destruction that we just think of when it comes to war, where, you know, millions of people are dying. And up until that point, it was like thousands or tens of thousands of people. It was really bad, but not friggin' millions.
Right.
You know, they're not dropping mustard gas on, you know, entire regiments and just annihilating people, where it was just this, Bruce, so it was this transition of this romanticized ideology of what warfare really was and what it meant to go to war.
Right.
It was just annihilated for people, and it turned into this real horrible experience where it's like nobody wants to go through that.
Yeah, and I mean, like I said, you know, I have a thing for it, and I liked it. I like it. I'm intrigued by it, but of course I don't wish anything or anything bad on anybody, of course.
Yeah.
We all want a very peaceful world, you know, and I thought that's where we were, but there's always this moment where we gotta watch our back.
Yeah.
And protect what's here.
Well, that's really all that keeps the peace, man, is someone has the biggest stick. You know, and whoever has the biggest stick or the largest nuclear arsenal or the biggest navy,
yeah,
those are the ones that kind of say, well, it's peacetime for us.
Yeah.
And, you know, we'll keep shit in check. And that's
right.
I mean, humans are brutal people. We're very violent and very greedy. And it's just, it's natural for people to try to take advantage of every situation.
No different than
the
Roman times.
Yeah.
No different than,
right?
You know, 2,000 years ago. We're still fighting that mentally war with our life.
Yeah.
And our boundaries and our borders. We're still doing that.
It'll happen forever, man.
It'll happen forever. That's the crazy part.
Yeah.
It'll happen forever.
I mean, what are we going to do? You know, everyone just going to all of a sudden think the exact same way? 8 billion right. people are going to just like come to the same conclusion? That's not going to happen.
Love, peace, and hair grease?
Yeah, exactly. It would be nice. I would love that so much.
Ringo Starr would be the guy to get that going.
Yeah.
You know, peace and love. Peace and love. Peace and
I
love.
I always say peace and love, man.
Do you remember when he started telling everybody, you don't send me any more requests for signatures? Like I think it was either on Howard Stern or he said something. And it's a great soundbite. He's like, listen, after January 1st, no more signatures. I'm done. Nothing for fans. Nothing in the mail. Nothing. I'm done.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's peace and love. Peace and love. Peace and love. But no more. He's like, imagine
probably
being
getting overwhelmed.
Yeah. Could you imagine that you're that crazy? Like you're a Beatle. I mean,
yeah.
Obviously, but people just want something out of you all the time.
Yeah.
That's a war to fight in your mind.
He's probably getting just giant bagfuls of mail every day asking.
Every year, every decade, constantly. Still. After he told everybody stop.
They're still sending it to
double him, right? Now everybody's a double down.
Yeah. Now, you know, it's he's just such a legend, man.
He really is.
That was the ultimate, man, the Beatles. That was the first huge, real, big pop sensation that, like, people, you know, you see videos of people screaming at them and just freaking out just to be in their presence.
Yeah.
And the idolization, man, it's just intense.
Oh, God.
And then that'll just be legendary forever.
And how it lasts still.
Yeah.
Even in the generations before us now, they're just so deep into it.
Oh, yeah. I love the Beatles, man.
Me too.
I really wish Paul McCartney tickets weren't $300 a piece. I really wanted to go to that.
And
now that I didn't
seats?
Go, I regret not spending it after I missed it.
Do you remember House Seats? Do you know what House Seats is?
Yeah, yeah.
Right? So you pay the subscription and tickets pop up. And, you know, there's usually things all the time. Carrot Top and the topless shows and the reviews. And
I mean, they got to fill that all the time.
Every once in a while, you get lucky, right? So if you're lucky and you're there at the right moment searching for things, like we got like $600 Shania Twain tickets.
Oh, you know, like, that's a good show.
It's a great show. We got a couple couple different things that were really wow factors. I've like way overpaid for the subscription. I think the subscription for the year was like $100. And if you're smart, you know, and stay up on it, you get the good shit.
I'm going to have to look into that.
So the day Paul McCartney came to town, like, we both just, like, were not, like, thinking clearly. We were thinking about it, but our minds didn't connect because we were, like, we both, like, after it happened, we were like, there's no way there's going to be Paul McCartney tickets. So why would we even look?
Yeah.
Paulie Walnuts, Paul Cunningham from Smashing Alice, posts the next day.
Fucko.
He fucking posted the next day. I got our seats on house seats for free. And me and Shanti were just so freaked out, mad. We were so upset. We were like, I can't believe we missed this opportunity. They gave away free seats for Paul McCartney. We were just like, no way. We didn't even think to look that day.
That's insane.
Yeah. And I just, of course, something in me was like, look, don't look. No, forget it.
Yeah.
There's no way. Yeah, I missed a huge opportunity right there.
Yeah, if I'm fortunate enough for him to come back, it's like no price is too high, man. I gotta go see that show.
I want to see
one living Beatle before I die.
I'm with you on that.
Before he dies,
sure. A buddy I used to tour with Twisted, Matty, he was at a place, or maybe him and his buddy or his brother were at a place, and they announced at this like small bar that it could only hold like 60 people. They just said, hey, we're selling 60 tickets, but cash only, whoever shows up. And it was Paul McCartney and his band playing.
No way.
To like, I mean, maybe it was 100 people. It was not more than like 115 people.
Those are the best.
And he's like, you have to see this video. You have to see this video. Watch. And I was just like, you gotta be fucking kidding me. And it's just Paul jamming. It's different in a club. It's a different feel.
Yeah.
Now you're with the band.
Yeah.
You know, me and my wife talk about that. We just cry imagining that. Could you imagine that, to just be 20 feet away from Paul and just watching him play his instrument?
What an opportunity, man.
I saw some crazy conspiracy the other day. I don't fucking believe it. There's no way nobody's convincing me that Paul McCartney is dead or has been dead.
No.
But this guy did a TikTok video, and he's pretty good. He was, like, fun. You know, I enjoyed the humor in it. But, like, you know, he's like, you know, the Sgt. Pepper and the album cover. It's the funeral that, you know, that they wish they could have, but they couldn't have because the media, and then they replaced them. I'm like, it's interesting, but no.
No.
Nobody's that fucking amazing.
Everybody would be talking about that instantly. That would be worldwide news.
Yeah.
I mean, I'd imagine he's going to have a huge turnout like Michael Jackson did for his funeral.
I mean, yeah, this is in like, you know, the 60s, you know, before Sgt. Pepper, which they, you know, there was like a story in the paper that Paul was dead, you know, so they tried to build this for years that Paul was really dead.
Oh, that the guy that's walking around as Paul is an impersonator.
Correct.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay, now I get what you're saying.
So that's what Sgt. Pepper was supposed to be about. It was supposed to be the funeral that he never had, because the stars that would have showed up for Paul McCartney, they only put him on the album cover.
Yeah.
So it's like, that's a great story, but so is the fucking Bible.
Yeah.
Right? So, like, I love this story. Humor me all day, but I'm going to go with what my gut's telling me, you know? Paul's alive, and he's very vegan.
Right? Oh, man. Yeah, he definitely looks like Paul McCartney to me still, man.
There's no doubt.
Come on. Get out of here with that.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I mean, you know, it's fun to see those kind of conspiracy theories and ponder it for a second.
Sure.
That's what they're for, right?
Yeah.
Just to be like, what if?
What exactly. If? What if John was still alive?
Right.
My buddy, Danny from Collier, he's got a good theory about Jim Morrison. He swears he's alive.
Yeah, he's in a hospital in France.
Yeah.
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 Didn't they do a DNA test on that guy? Did they say it was Jim Morrison? Someone had a lock of Jim's hair from the 70s.
Yeah.
And they matched it to the guy supposedly in France.
Yeah, they checked, you know, because the part of the story that sells me the most and the best, the most humorous part is, like, you know, you don't have to ID a body in France. So, like, that's like the law. You don't have to ID. So he just disappeared or whatever.
Yeah.
You know, how cool would that really be if he really came out?
If he did have a lot of shit going on, because he pretended to pull his, you know, he stuck his finger through his pants or whatever and pretended to pull his dick out.
Sure.
And I forget what state, but it was a really religious state, and they were gonna press serious charges against him, and then press like lewdity in front of a minor and stuff like that, because it was like an all ages show, and they were gunning for him. They were gonna throw him in a cage for the rest of his life if he came back to the States. And so there was good reason for him to fake his death.
Interesting.
And he moved to France and supposedly died in France.
You know, out of all the rock stars who have died in any conspiracy that exists with them, it's got to be one.
Yeah.
There's got to be one who faked their death. You always wonder about Elvis. You always wonder about Jim. I don't think Jimmy was really... I'm pretty sure Jimmy really passed, you know. But
you know, he was doing a lot of dope, man. Yeah. A lot of Jack Daniels.
Sure. You know. But it's fun to go down those lanes.
The guy looks like Jim, though. The conspiracy theory I saw, man. I mean, this I was gonna bring this up before you did. Yeah, it was a good topic. But yeah, and then I do believe the article I read said they did DNA matching against the lock of hair and everything. So I mean, it's really possible that Jim Morrison faked his death, and this old guy hanging out in this retirement home is the legend, the Lizard King.
The real Lizard King.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
I've always been a Jim fan, man.
Really?
Yeah.
It took me a little while. I mean, I appreciate the Doors. I can't call myself a legit fan. You know, I like to listen to them, but I think I need to, like... sometimes it takes me 40 years to fall in love with something. You know what I mean? But I think like after this conversation, it's a good chance for me to really listen to an album full through and really understand it. Because that's how you really understand a band, is by listening to an album, not a song.
Yeah. You know?
But,
or seeing them live.
Oh.
Depends on the band, man.
Yeah. You know,
some bands need to be seen live.
Correct.
And some bands, like they're a studio band.
Uh-huh.
And I love having my opinion change that way.
Sure.
For sure, man.
Oh yeah.
I fell in love with bands way later on in life that I just thought were garbage.
Sure.
And then it's like, oh no, and then you see them live and you're like, that's what the songs are about, man. The records didn't do them justice. This is all live shit they're supposed to be playing.
Yeah, totally.
You know. Yeah. That's
I envy that. I want to get back to that. I want to be that. Play my own shit.
Let's see. This is a
bleed on the stage.
But while we were still talking about it, let me zoom in a little bit here and pull this shot up real quick here of what supposedly is Jim.
That's
great. Drinking a beer or whatever. That's funny. I mean, that could be him. I saw another one of him possibly in like
that's what
bed
he would
or
look
something like.
Like
that. Yeah, right. That's what he would look like. But yeah, it's supposed to be, he faked his death. That's
too funny.
Yeah, freaking Jim Morrison, man.
He missed a hell of a party in the late 70s, though. If he wasn't going to Studio 54, God, man, he missed a big party.
Well, shit, man. I think we've been talking, it's almost 2 hours now.
It's always a flash in the pan.
It just goes so fast, man.
I enjoy it. I enjoy thank you for having me.
Thank you.
I appreciate it. Return customer.
Yeah. It's nice to have you back on the show, man.
And I know about the future guest, but you don't know about the future guest. But you got a lot of cool stuff coming here, so I'm very, very excited for you.
I'm very excited as well, man. I'm really going to try to bring some of the, try to get some really interesting guests on the show. And, people really respond well to the music stuff, and I know a lot of interesting musicians. So
yes, you do.
Well, I'm looking forward to what the future holds here on To the Fullest at Space Brain Station.
Yeah.
Yeah, man.
Like and subscribe.
Thank you so much.
Support.
Yeah, thanks, Keith, for coming on.
Thank you.
And peace.
Rock and roll.
Thanks for watching To the Fullest with Jason Froberg. You can check out more podcasts here and subscribe by clicking right here. We air new podcasts every Monday morning on Space Brain Station and all of your favorite podcast apps.